Okay, folks, we're going to get started. Yeah. Just looking for your cue, AGP. Okay, thank you. All right. Welcome, everyone. Today is Tuesday, September 22nd. We are now entering our regular city council meeting. For those viewers watching, we did have a study session previously that ran over, so we're getting started approximately 6:37. We are located at the Veterans Memorial Hall, 209 Surf Street, here in Morro Bay. For the record, all council members, we have council members present with the exception of Mr. Makowetsky. With that, we'll call the meeting to order, and please join me in a moment of silence. Thank you. And with that, Dana, would you lead us in the pledge? Thank you, Dana. We have our closed session report. Mr. Pannoni?
There was one item on the agenda. It was discussed, but there was no reportable action.
Thank you very much. Council members, reports and announcements to my right? None? Thank you. None for me as well. We'll move on to public presentations, which we have none tonight. And before we get into public comment, I know we have quite a few things on the agenda. We're going to try to accelerate through some of that. Just a show of hands, who's here for the sanctuary item D3? Okay, so with consensus from council, we can move that up. Because the first public hearings, we have none, so we can move up. Just need consensus on moving item D3 to the front of the agenda. We have some agreement there?
Yes.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and bump that up first. So we'll with that, we'll go into public comment, we'll go into our consent agenda, and then we'll start the item D3, which was the Harbor Advisory Recommendation for the Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary. And so with that, we do open our public comment with a business spot, and we have a Mr. Richard Rowe from Rowe Clay Works that's gonna open public comment for us, and he's the business spot of the week. Welcome, Richard.
Hi, my name is Richard Rowe, and I'm the owner of Rowe Clay Works. You can find me at 387B Quintana Road. That's here in town. I'm in the same complex as the Couch Potato, and I'm way in the back, so you got to look for me. I'm open Monday through Saturday, usually 10 to 5. However, I'm primarily a wholesaler, so you catch me when you can. If the door's open, come on by. I do have a showroom, and be glad to sell you some pieces if you come by. I've been here since 1988. I used to own Cayucas Clay Works, which was in business for roughly 15 years, and then I moved over to Los Osos to Moonstone Pottery. And this is my first year in Morro Bay at the location I'm at. What I do is I make functional pottery. I brought two pieces, kind of hard to see from a distance, but a mug and a planter. I make my work affordable and functional. You can use it in the microwave. You can use it in the conventional oven. You can put it in the dishwasher. You can throw it at people, whatever you'd like to do with it. As far as what I've been doing, I've been making pottery since 1976 and supporting myself doing it. And I've worked with the California Arts Council in Southern California with a grant to teach. I've worked up here with Children's Creative Project, and I've taught College for Kids at Cuesta College for 5 years. So I try and work with the community, and this is my first year in the city of Morro Bay, so it's taken me a while to get used to all the ramifications of working in a city. The county was much easier to deal with as far as regulations go. If you'd like to get a hold of me, you can find me at roclayworks.com online, or you can call me at 805-235-9721. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Richard. Do you have any of your more cards that you can leave in the back there?
I can. I'll leave a stack back there.
Great. Thank you very much. And with that, we'll open up public comment for items not on the agenda. You have 3 minutes. Please come forward. Pardon me? This is public comment for items not on the agenda. We'll get to the other in a moment.
Okay. I'm having a little trouble with my voice. Good evening, City Council. I'm Rosalie Valvo of Morro Bay. Last week, I read an article in the Tribune that worried me very much. Floating wind turbines are being proposed for off Morro Bay. The part that concerned me most was the lack of the mention of birds in the article. Wind turbines are notorious for killing birds. An article at Smithsonian.com reviewed various sources and estimated between 140,000 and 328,000 birds die each year from collisions with wind turbines. The American Bird Conservancy's estimate is over 500,000. I support alternative energy, but I also support birds. A future filled with wind turbines but no birds does not sound good to me. The American Bird Conservancy has a program that addresses this called Bird Smart Wind Energy. Most critical, it says, is proper siting. The proposed siting of this project is in the Pacific Flyway, a much-used bird migration path. I beg all interests, Trident Winds, Morro Bay City Council, and everyone else to carefully consider this. We need a good project. Thank you for putting up with me.
Thanks, Rosalie.
Exciting place here in Morro Bay. Good evening, Mr. Mayor, City Council. My name is Rigmore. I'm a resident of Morro Bay. Since I previously last year at the City Council meeting pushed for selling fresh fish at the docks, I'm extremely happy to now be able to pre-order fish coming in directly from the fishermen by emailing what I want to have as fish to go fish at southbaywild.com. Last week, I picked up 5 whole fish because I like the whole fish, but they will clean it, fillet it, or give it to you in any form you want. You can order lingcod, Dover sole, etc. The last ones I picked up was chili pepper rockfish, and they were oh so good. Regarding the issue coming up tonight, I will just, my feelings are the same as in my 3-minute comment at the City Council meeting July 15 regarding the water meters. At the end, I would like to suggest that when printing up the new design guidelines, you print the word guidelines in bold, bold letters. Hate to see this cute coastal city putting people in cages who have great, unusual, interesting, and artistic ideas. And I would 100% support Morro Bay being a marine sanctuary. I miss the parklet. And I still think you would regret if you allow a boat haul out here in Morro Bay. Thank you.
Thank you, Rigmore. Anybody else for public comment for items not on the agenda?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members, and staff. I'm Doug Clausen, manager and one of the owners of Morro Dunes at 1700 Embarcadero along on the north side of the creek. And that's kind of why I'm here tonight, about the homeless problem I'm having. They're stealing from me. They're using my bathrooms. They go through my garbage day and night. They panhandle through the fence at my customers. I'd like to see the creek clear like at Lila Kaiser, where there's no limbs underneath the trees. I've had several calls into staff, but I haven't received one yet. I have signs up that they're trespassing and they can be arrested. The police department is helping me out a lot. And for like illegal camping, you have signs that are coming into the town. It says no camping except in designated camping areas. Why can't you enforce that? This has been going on the last 2 weeks. I've had a lot of complaints for people. And I don't want to have my blogs about Morro Dunes. Don't come to Morro Dunes. The homeless are taking over. With that, good night.
Thank you, Mr. Clausen.
Melody DeMerritt, Morro Bay. Over the weekend, EcoSlow managed the Great Coastal Cleanup, a yearly event. And my site included the creek that the previous talker was talking about. Are you guys all listening? I don't know. Because I think it's kind of important, this problem that's going on in that creek bed, from a slightly different stance. We hauled 300 pounds of trash out of that creek from the bridge, the beautiful bridge that we put in that is, of course, attracting tourists. And on that bridge, they can look down in that creek bed and see enormous amounts of trash. But from that bridge, not even to Lila Kaiser, we couldn't make it up there. We couldn't get the stuff hauled out fast enough. What can we do? Now, I am not necessarily for rousting the homeless, because we've done that before. You guys didn't, but we knocked down 16 camps down there, but all they do is come down, sleep on park benches down here. I don't know what recourse they have. Then they all go back down there. So as we were going down there, there were at least 4 active camps. But there is trash down there that is dangerous. If we get an El Nino this year, that trash is going to be going down into the ocean, where our fishermen fish, by the way. Ironing boards, cassette players, I am certain that he's right. When we were looking at things, we said, where is this stuff coming from? It's being lifted off of that campground. It's being lifted off of front yards, backyards, whatever. Oh, cheap booze bottles, beer bottles, of course you expect that, but mattresses, quilted blankets, lovely knitted things, jean jackets. I mean, it was just enormous. Now, I've thought and thought, and the only thing I can think is at least... Well, one thing I think, he's probably right that we need to scrape it. So much of that stuff is just stuck in the mud. We couldn't get it out. And it's pollution that's going to go into the ocean. I'm thinking maybe metal trash barrels. 5 metal trash barrels from the Highway 1 bridge all the way down to the new bridge, locked to trees because they'll cart them off too. I don't know what else to do. I've been thinking and thinking. I can't come up with it. But one thing we have to do is we have to clean that creek. Thank you.
Thank you, Melody.
Yeah, I'm Butch Powers, fisherman, and I'd like to say to the mayor, you need to look for a new job because you will not be reelected in Morro Bay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name's Emily Miggins. I'm actually a resident of Los Osos, but I'm here with my mom this evening, who's a resident of Morro Bay. And just these previous comments, this is kind of just impromptu. You know, a lot of communities all over California, I'm a new transplant here, following my parents to this beautiful area, have established either ad hoc sustainability committees and or sustainability managers that sometimes are unfunded until they can seek the government funding, including things like building the appropriate recycling infrastructure, building volunteer cleanups for things like natural resources around the area, dealing with issues with staff, which might be legally prepared to answer things like whether or not a marine sanctuary is, you know, appropriate or not for this area. But I think most importantly, there are people that are educated in these issues and that use baseline sustainability metrics and reporting standards recognized by the state of California and are funded by state agencies, in communities. And small communities, including communities like Walnut Creek or, El Cerrito up in the North Bay, I can list off many around LA and San Diego, move aggressively on these issues because we're in a time of climate change. We're in, obviously, a statewide drought, et cetera. And I would highly recommend that that the city council and staff think about ways to innovate because we are in a precious area. And I would say most communities around here aren't leading the way towards coming up and innovating with community-based strategies to address many of these pressing issues, including increased tourism and the impact that that has on our natural resources. So it's just a suggestion, and I think it's an important one because generationally things are changing as well, and what makes you marketable and attractive to the next generation that's going to be filling in the shoes of those that are currently dominant here. Thank you.
I didn't get her name. Excuse me, could we get your name? I don't think we got your name, just for the record. Thank you. Yeah.
It's Emily Miggins, spelled M-I-G-G-I-N-S.
Okay. Thanks, Emily. Appreciate it.
Hello, Council, and everyone here tonight. Trina Doherty, resident of Morro Bay and president of the Eco Rotary Club of Morro Bay. Tonight, I'd like to invite everybody to an event that we're having on Thursday, this Thursday, September 24th. It's called Can I Recycle This? And it'll be held at 5:30 at the Morro Bay Community Center Multipurpose Room. This is going to be a free presentation by Mike DeMilo of the IWMA, Integrated Waste Management Authority. And it's a chance for everybody to get the real facts on what can and cannot be recycled. It's great tips for your business, home, event venue, or local gathering place. Standard items are really easy. We know all about the, water bottles and cans and some of the big things. But what about the little items that we sit there and go, can I or can I not recycle this? So we're going to find out about that. And when you do find out, it makes you a smarter consumer. So you can decide, am I going to purchase this? And if so, is it going to go in the landfill? And am I okay with that? For example, I, as everyone knows, I love Clif Bars. I love them. They have a Mylar inside. You cannot recycle this. So I was coming to the conclusion that I was just going to not be able to eat Clif Bars anymore. So I contacted the company and come to find out they partner with a recycling organization called TerraCycle, and they actually collect these. They make backpacks, benches, all kinds of things. They upcycle these and a lot of other items like Brita water filters and all kinds of things. And they actually give you 1 to 2 cents per unit towards your favorite nonprofit. So, there are ways that we can help the planet and also help our local landfill. So you're also welcome to bring a small non-hazardous item with you. Mike will answer those questions for you. Everyone is welcome. There'll be light refreshments. Snacks are always good. And so, again, this Thursday, 9:24, at 5:30, at the multi-use room at the community center. Thank you.
Thank you, Trina.
Mr. Mayor, council members, good evening. My name's Robert Davis, and I live in Morro Bay. I'm speaking tonight as a representative of the San Luis Obispo Bicycle Club to let you know about an annual bicycling event that's coming to Morro Bay next weekend. The bike club is going to host its 44th annual Lighthouse Bike Ride on Saturday, September the 26th. We expect about 1,400 bike riders on the route starting at 7 a.m. We tell the riders that we require them to ride safely, to observe traffic laws, to share the road with cars, and to respect local residents. Starting point is Morro Bay High School. Cyclists will exit the high school parking lot onto Atascadero Road, turn onto Highway 1, and ride north to Piedras Blancas, and then they'll ride back to Morro Bay. The course opens at 7 and closes at 5. Morro Bay Police will help direct traffic around the high school in the morning, and CHP will patrol the route. We will not allow cyclists to park their cars at Lila Kaiser Park. They will park at the high school and on Atascadero Road, but we will not allow them access to the park. This is not a race. It's a recreational ride that's designed for people to have fun on their bicycles. This is one of the bike club's two annual fundraising events. We raise money to contribute to local high school and college scholarships and to support local nonprofit organizations. This year, we're donating almost $100,000 from our events to San Luis Obispo County schools and organizations. That includes donations to the Morro Bay Police Volunteers, to the Morro Bay 4th of July Bike Parade, a $2,000 donation to the high school, $1,000 to support a bike safety awareness program that Morro Bay Citizens Bike Committee is conducting. And last year, the bike club contributed $5,000 to support the Morro Bay Bike Park. The club is also donating $10,000 to the high school booster club for helping us to serve barbecue dinners after the riders finish the ride. We also are encouraging the cyclists to spend the weekend in Morro Bay and to spend their money here. We try hard to work with local communities and law enforcement to make the ride safe for everyone and to minimize the impact of the event. We ask that you and everyone here please pass your word to the neighbors, let them know about the ride. And if you need more information, you can call the club at 543-5973. Thank you.
Safe riding, Red. That was September 26th.
John Elliott, and I'm here to talk about the Halloween trick-or-treat, downtown trick-or-treat event that we put on last year. And we've formed a committee this year to help with the event. And basically, there's a flyer that explains some of the details of the event. We're going to be inviting the Embarcadero businesses and all other businesses not in the MAP area this year to set up a table and participate. And the details, our committee's finalizing some of the last details, so this is just a save the date. It's on Halloween, Saturday this year, from 2 to 5 p.m. in the downtown area. And businesses that want to participate can email me at morrobaybarbershop@gmail.com. I will be going around to businesses again this year, but it's just to save the date. So any business that wants to participate, please contact me.
Thanks, John. Anybody else for public comment?
My name is Betty Winholtz. The intent of my following statement is to empower the council. The city council as a body sets the direction in which staff is to fulfill the council's desires. Equally important, city council sets the tone for accomplishing this direction. So a recent event has me speculating as to the tone that you want to promote with regard to this item. This is an event I have commented on before. It's the case of the Grillies on Kern Street. 40-plus year residents sued by the neighbor behind them on Arbutus for not cutting their backyard trees the way the neighbor wants them, now experiencing double indemnity because criminal charges have been filed against them by the city attorney for the same offense. Without going into the particulars of the case, what is worrisome is that the members of the city council may believe that they have no recourse in this matter, assuming that they may want to. That they may want to have a say on how city money is spent, on whether we should sue our elderly over a private matter. I believe that you do have recourse. First, obviously, the city attorney serves at your pleasure. Second, council controls the attorney's budget, so you could limit the discretionary spending. Third, the council sets policy, so they could set the parameters of what kinds of cases they want money spent on. And fourth, the last time that the Muni Code that deals with the section on city attorney was updated, was in 2010, when we had a full-time city attorney. So there may be changes you want to deal with that, because now we have outside counsel that works not full-time, but by the hour, and therefore would be the money situation becomes a question. So I am uncomfortable if council feels they have no control over city funds and who gets sued. It's a tone of being a victim, not in charge, not being leaders. So it's curious that the tone of reconciliation in the new, quote, community enhancement, i.e. code enforcement program, has not been extended to the Grillies. I am uncomfortable with this tone of discrimination. You may build the finest wastewater treatment plant that the world has ever seen, but at home, you will be remembered as how you deal with the least of us.
Thank you. Anybody else for public comment?
Fred Collins, Tribal Administrator, Northern Chumash Tribal Council. Mayor Irons, Council, thank you for the opportunity to speak. I've been absent at several of the meetings involving the wastewater treatment process that you folks have been leading here, and I want to thank you for the direction that you've taken with this project. You've looked at all of the options, and you paid attention to the people that, you know, that have come forward here and spoke to you, and I want to commend you for that, because for us, you know, we believe you picked the best place. It's going to avoid cultural resources. We still have to be careful in you know, the underground work and stuff that we do. But, you know, it's great to think that we may be able to get rid of our outfall also. So, again, thank you very much for that direction.
Thank you, Fred.
Buonasera, mi amici. Il mio nome è Rob Livick. I'm here to let you know about a fantastic opportunity to see an opera double feature. Opera San Luis Obispo is celebrating its 30-year anniversary by presenting two Verissimo, which are real-life style operas, Cavalleria Rusticana and Pagliacci. These will include performances by the Central Coast Children's Choir, which features Dave's daughter, Kate, and many other community vocal ensembles and dance groups. I will actually be making my opera debut singing with the grand chorus as a baritone and playing the role of a Italian beggar. Please come out and enjoy a great performance on either October 10th at 7 p.m. Or 11th at 2 p.m., and tickets are available at paxslow.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob. Anybody else for public comment? Seeing none, we'll close public comment and bring it back to council. And before we get on, Joe, can you respond to Ms. Winholt's comments on the Crillies?
Respond in the nature of the status, or respond, I'm not quite sure.
And just the legal clarification on the position on that, there's a clarification on the legalities of that, whether or not it's criminal, and how that, I think we've responded to that once before. I just want to make sure that we're clear on that.
There's a municipal code provision that prohibits certain plantings to be above a certain height, and the property owner's plantings are above that height, and there's been an ongoing struggle to get the property owner to correct that situation, and this is one aspect of trying to get it corrected.
Okay. John?
Mr. Pennelly, what... given the fact that I believe the majority of the discussion, if not all, has been in closed session, what would your advice for a council person be in terms of either interaction with the Grillies or any party like that, and or what a council person might be able to do.
The particular situation we're talking about is a matter that's being handled as through the city prosecutor function of the city attorney's office. The city council should not get themselves involved at all in what the city prosecutor does, because that can lead to a court determining that prosecutorial discretion is not being properly followed, which is an ultimate need, or a court will not let the city enforce its laws because they think the council is making political decisions rather than just having the city prosecute as they determine necessary. So with regard to the particular matter that is before the court that the city is involved with, that's a criminal matter. So my suggestion is that if the council has asked anything from the public about that, that the council say that's a criminal matter and you can't comment on it.
Thank you.
Thanks. Anybody else? Christine?
I have another item.
On something else, but not on that item.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm responding. I don't know. Maybe it's the same thing as Noah wants to respond to. Okay. Definitely, Mr. Clausen and Ms. Demerit's comments were taken to heart. And Noah Smuckler and I, Councilmember Smuckler and I, are the liaisons to the Estero Bay Alliance for Care, which some of you may know, some of you may not know. It's a loose network of groups in Morro Bay, and sometimes we have people coming to meet with us from Cayucas and Los Osos. We almost always have people meeting with us from social service agencies in the county. We get together once a month and we talk about all kinds of issues in our city that have to do with of a helping nature. So certainly the city doesn't have any resources here to help folks who don't have a place to live. The county-wide occupancy, I think, vacancy rate in terms of rentals is less than 2%. So we have a critical need for housing on all levels in our county, including housing for folks who are very low income. So given that you've heard some reported facts from folks who are actively volunteering or actively doing business near the creek, those things, the city is fully have been made aware of those fully over the last week and a half. Mr. Clausen was able to come to our last Estero Bay Alliance for Care meeting and share those concerns directly with Councilmember Smuckler and I, the group who's organized there, as well as the police chief. So I don't know how much more staff wants to comment on it, but certainly we are aware and we are listening, and it looks like the city manager may be responding.
Yeah, I'll just take a moment. Thank you, Councilmember Johnson. The from the city's complex problem around California, it's a long-term problem. The city does have a measurable concern with health and safety, particularly in the Morro Creek area with the potential of significant rains. About this time last year, the city did significant clearing of vegetation in the creek. I'll note that about a month ago, we had a fairly significant fire in the creek with 20-foot flames. So that the health and safety aspects, particularly of Morro Creek, clearly has our attention. We met as recently as last Wednesday and Thursday, two separate meetings, to consider creek maintenance, both reducing the fire hazard and reducing the pollution hazard and reducing the environmental hazard of flooding in what was an over-vegetated creek bed. So the city is the city staff is looking at some fairly near-term activity in order to do maintenance in the creek area to promote the health and safety of the community.
Yeah, John.
Thank you, City Manager. I appreciate that. Mr. Clausen phoned me a week and a half ago, and I believe I emailed appropriate city staff, and so I appreciate that response. and especially Chief Christie for your response, and also for the work that you've done in that area to help mitigate the issue as much as possible without being overly aggressive in dealing with a very difficult situation. Did anybody get back to Mr. Clausen regarding the creek bed cleanup? Would be my question, and if not, when could that happen?
We'll certainly, I know that that evening he spoke with Councilmember Smuckler and Johnson at the EBAC meeting, and I'll make sure that we close the loop with him in particular. I'll also note that the city receives both from our citizens and from doing the work the city does, primarily our great police department. We see the effects daily, perhaps a few times weekly, maybe not daily, the police seeing the effects. They probably see it daily of this issue in our city, and work to address it all the time. I'll say that on a recent 4-hour ride about, I went on with our police department. We engaged 4 different transient homeless folks. The police department did a great job engaging them, a great job being both firm and compassionate. So it has the eye of the city staff, and we'll work to better communicate to the community what action we are taking, because it's a challenge for many of our law-abiding citizens, and it's a challenge in life for those folks who don't have a place to sleep at night.
Just as a follow-up comment, I might offer one piece of advice regarding public health issues, and that is I've seen an uptick in my business, my pharmacy, with regard to needle exchange, which is legal in California. And I can't categorize, but they appear to be homeless folks. And so I would caution anybody involved in that cleanup that you need to be very careful that you do not have needle stick issues as you forage around in the foliage. There could be needles, and communicable diseases like Hep C, HIV, are transmittable, and so that would be a significant concern for anybody involved in cleanup that I would just add. Thank you.
Thank you, John. John, Noah?
Yes, I would like to follow up. As Ms. Johnson mentioned, I am also co-chair of the Estero Bay Alliance of Care. We've been working over the last couple of years to try to get our hands around a very challenging issue in our community that has grown with the recession. And one of the philosophies that the Estero Bay Alliance for Care and our network has embraced is the idea that we're working to help people with a hand up but not a hand out, working to balance the potential of enabling and supporting a lifestyle rather than trying to help them work towards self-sufficiency. And it's something that it's going to be a very challenging process, and we have limited resources within the county. The Estero Bay Alliance for Care, the Resource Connection Office, and our Monday Dinners are all working hard to grow our ability to collaborate and help people in need, and balance that with the public health and safety conversation that we're taking very seriously. We are planning and working with city staff to come up with a good plan to address the potential of a large El Nino event and what that would mean for water quality and the safety of people living in the creek as well, and to outreach to them, make sure that they understand and are aware of the opportunities that do exist to help them, and that we take responsibility for this area. So if someone is interested, and I plan on following up with Ms. Demerit, we've already been contacted by a group of surfers who want to get involved with the cleanup. We clearly would need to have a training program and hazardous materials handling understanding to be effective in this. But the goal is to establish the plan and implement it by the end of October. So if anyone is interested in getting involved, you can contact me at 772-7668. We already have a number of people that are willing to help, and very much appreciated on that. And obviously, it's a big job, so we'd encourage more, and we'll work to make sure that it's safe and effective.
Thanks, Noah. And that concludes our public comment response. We'll move on to the consent agenda. I have item A5 that I'd like to pull. Anybody else have any items to pull on consent? Seeing none, I'll open it up for public comment for anybody who'd like to speak to anything on consent. Seeing none, I'll close public comment and bring it back to council. I'd make a motion to approve items A1 through A4.
Second.
We have a motion by Mayor Irons, second by Mr. Heading. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None. Motion carries 4-0. I wanted to pull item A5. A5 is approval of two new lease agreements between the City of Morro Bay and GAFCO Harbor Hut for the use of public property in front of Front Street parking lot and the trash enclosures. I know this is a simple, somewhat of a simple lease assignment. There are some requirements as far as cleanup, and that site hasn't been cleaned up to date. So I would like to have discussion and get support on continuing this item until the facilities are actually cleaned up, and then we'll bring this item back when it's cleaned up and we can discuss it then. I think we've had some discussions on this item, and as of when I checked on this before coming over, it was still in disrepair. So I would just ask for any other discussion or support on continuing this item until it gets cleaned up. Support that? Okay. So with that, I'd make a motion to continue item A5 until the site and area is cleaned up, and then we can bring it back for discussion then. That's my motion.
I'll second for just a moment of discussion.
Okay. So we have a motion by Mayor Irons, a second by Councilmember Johnson. Discussion?
Just wondering that that's clear. Has the city been very clear about what the expectations are in terms of cleanup?
I think it's actually clear in the lease document in of itself. So I think that just I would just use that as a guideline. Any comments, Eric or Dave? No? Okay. All good? Okay, with that, all in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? None. Motion carries 4-0. Moving on, we have public hearings, but we're going to make an adjustment and move on to item D3. Item D3 is consideration of Harbor Advisory Board recommendation on Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary nomination and possible city council position. The recommendation is to consider the Harbor Advisory Board recommendation on Council Chumash National Marine Sanctuary nomination. And with that, we'll move to the staff report.
Okay, is that working? All right, up front and center here. I do not have a PowerPoint presentation. I have a PaperPoint presentation. Not up to speed on PowerPoint yet. So thank you and good evening, Mayor Irons and Council. Potential establishment of a National Marine Sanctuary in area waters is a long-standing issue that has a long history here in Morro Bay, I think beginning back in the early 1990s, early to mid-90s, and continues today. Most recently, a Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary proposal is under consideration by NOAA, the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration, for placement of that nomination on an inventory list for possible consideration in the future, meaning if it's accepted by NOAA, it'll be put on an inventory list, and then NOAA in some future time, to be determined, may pull off that list from around the country of nominations that have been accepted to possibly consider future establishment of a sanctuary here. NOAA is set to make a ruling on that proposal in early October, which is the reason we have it in front of you here tonight, and we went in front of the Harbor Advisory Board a couple of weeks ago as well to have the Harbor Advisory Board weigh in. The proposal was considered by the Harbor Advisory Board at the September 15th special meeting, We had a fair number of people in attendance there. At the end, after about an hour of deliberation and public comment, the Harbor Advisory Board voted 7-0 unanimously to recommend the City Council not change its current stance on sanctuary designation in local waters per the standing resolutions that we have. And I'll get to that. We've got some resolutions that have been in existence for a while now. There's passionate arguments both for and against sanctuary establishment. There's a lot of science on both sides of the issue. I've got some of that here. I can certainly go into some details if need be. Morro Bay's historic reluctance to support sanctuary designation in our waters has generally fallen into these three categories, and again, going back to some resolutions. The first is that the National Marine Sanctuary Program has not resolved continued concerns and conflicts with the commercial fishing industry. Number two, the National Marine Sanctuary Program has not resolved continued concerns and conflicts with working harbors and the communities that surround those harbors. And the third general issue is that one of loss of local control with a federal program coming in and federal oversight. National Marine Sanctuary Program, obviously a federal program, and nationalizing those resources as opposed to keeping them local. So those are the three general themes that all the council oppositions over the years have fallen into. The city has been on record four times since 2000 in opposition to sanctuary designation. The stipulation has been until the issues identified are resolved. I don't know. Some of the council resolutions have been specific towards sanctuaries. Specific sanctuaries are being proposed. Most of the opposition is characterized more in terms of the National Marine Sanctuary Act and fixing the act as a larger process rather than an individual sanctuary proposal in front of them. The fishing industry, the California Marine Affairs and Navigation Conference, the Alliance of Communities for Sustainable Fisheries, your sister harbor managers up and down the coast, and the Harbor Advisory Board still believe the issues are relevant and still not resolved. And that's primarily why the Harbor Advisory Board voted a couple weeks ago to continue the city's opposition stance to marine sanctuaries until those issues are resolved. So tonight, several alternatives. Obviously, we'll get a good amount of public comment here. The alternatives are continuing or adopting the Harbor Advisory Board's recommendation from the 15th that the City of Morro Bay continue to oppose National Marine Sanctuary designation in area waters and direct staff to draft a letter to NOAA for the mayor's signature accordingly, expressing that feeling. Second alternative would be to not adopt the Harbor Advisory Board's recommendation and write a sanctuary support letter to NOAA for the mayor's signature accordingly. And a third alternative, and certainly these aren't the only, but these are the three that I've identified. The third alternative is do not take a support or opposed position on the Chumash Sanctuary nomination or any sanctuary designation in area waters and allow Resolution 1812 to stand. Resolution 1812, obviously by its numbers, was approved by the City Council in 2012. With those areas of opposition outlined, and that's the most recent City of Morro Bay resolution that's come to pass. If alternative one is chosen, which is continue in the vein of opposition to the marine sanctuary designation, staff's recommending that the City Council reiterates its support for Resolution 1812, which is included with the staff report. Also included as a staff report was the Harbor Advisory Board staff report. You'll notice the city staff report, tonight's staff report's fairly brief. The Harbor Advisory Board staff report had a lot of background, a lot of documentation, so I didn't want to repeat it. And then if alternative two is chosen, which is support of sanctuary designation or at least sanctuary nomination, staff recommends that the City Council tonight rescind Resolution 1812 as it would be in opposition to a sanctuary support position, and we can't have opposing documents out there. So with that, a lot of documentation there. I'm happy to answer questions, and I'm sure, again, we'll get a lot of good public comment as well.
Okay, with that, I'll bring it back for council questions. Then we'll open it up for public comment. And I'll just, through some corresponding emails, first of all, I appreciate all the emails that we got. There's one particular that in the email string, in the bottom of it, there was in bold letters, please be respectful in your comments. It was an email pursuing people to come out tonight and speak out against the marine sanctuary, and it was in an effort to say, hey, let's be respectful. It's an emotionally charged issue, and I would just ask everyone to be respectful and speak factual about their remarks and support or opposition for this particular issue. So with that, are there any particular questions? John, do you want to start out with any questions for staff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And thank you for the extensive documentation and list of information. I did take the time to read that in detail, including the history. I also had the opportunity to see the on TV the Harbor Advisory Board meeting and what they went through in terms of making a determination. And so a couple of questions that are left in my mind and trying to wrap myself around what I consider to be this hugely divergent issue in terms of the divergence between wanting to be respectful of the environment and maintain the integrity of said environment, and then also be fiduciarily responsible to my community and determine the actual impact that the sanctuary might have on various industries within the city, and the learnings possibly that you have from the experience in Monterey with the sanctuary there. And so with that kind of overview, I looked at the goals from the attachment 2 for the submission document, the most recent submission document, and the ones that particularly stand out to me, and there are 9 goals that are described that I believe are trying to be achieved. Number 3, protect, study, and interpret the region's maritime heritage and Chumash cultural heritage. With regard, and all these are in the context of maybe learnings from any of the existing, but especially Monterey Sanctuary. Can you possibly comment on the achievement of any of these types of goals specifically? And I know these are difficult questions, but do you have any examples of within Monterey, context of what they've done with that sanctuary, the ability to protect, study, and interpret the region's maritime heritage? And I'd leave off the Chumash issue because that's different, but I'll start with that.
Yeah, and I'm going to ask for a little clarification. So you're referring to the nomination process itself through the National Marine Sanctuary Act?
Yeah, it says attachment 2.
The 4 criteria.
Page 3, goals description.
Okay, let me.
Your page 3.
Let me dig that.
Sorry. Let's see if I can give you the
attachment number.
Page 1 title on that would help. The basic section 1, Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary proposal. Section 2, basics number 1, section 2, introduction.
Okay, I'm with you.
And then going to page number 3, it lists the goals, which to me basically are the bottom line of what they're trying to achieve with the designation. And so item number 3, protect, study, and interpret the region's maritime heritage. And I guess the goals I'm interested in, and I don't want to belabor this, so just maybe short answers of, and if you don't have knowledge, I would totally understand that, but maybe starting with that one.
Well, in terms of, so correct me if I'm wrong, you asked in context of the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary,
yes,
and other sanctuaries.
Yes.
I am unaware of the Monterey Bay sanctuaries, when it was designated and its designation documents and what it intended to do. I'm not aware of any Native American element that sanctuary had. I think it was primarily oil and gas development was the main driver for
that. Right, and that's
that
why
sanctuary.
I left off that last piece, just protecting, studying, and interpreting the region's maritime heritage.
I'm unaware of any of that in the national, in this Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary.
Establishing a comprehensive number 4 management program to address increasing offshore industrial threats to vital habitat, species, and heritage resources, and you could leave off heritage resources, but certainly I do believe that sanctuary had a similar goal.
Correct. Correct. That, I believe, speaks to the oil and gas and other type developments. That was the prime driver in Monterey. One of the prime drivers in Monterey.
Okay. And has it achieved that goal, met that goal, I guess, to your knowledge, to date?
There's been no offshore oil and gas development in Monterey.
Right.
In
yes, it has, huh?
So, yeah.
Okay. All right. And then number five, promote some more support and collaborate with scientific research institutions. Could you just generally make comments about your knowledge of any scientific advances that have come from that sanctuary?
Yeah, no, something I failed to say in my initial staff report, and I want to bring it up now. It's certainly marine sanctuary designation is not all doom and gloom. There's a lot of good things the sanctuaries have done. I think their primary achievements are those in research and education. Obviously, you've got the Monterey Bay Research Institute that popped up there, not tied directly to the sanctuary, but there in Monterey Bay, and it ties with sanctuary efforts and does a lot of things with the sanctuary. So I think the scientific research and monitoring and education outreach is one of the main things in Monterey Bay and all the national marine sanctuaries. I think it's one of their greatest strong points.
Great. Okay. And the last one, maybe the most important, is number nine, specifically with regard to particular sanctuary, protecting the economic health of the area. I do believe there was a similar goal for the Monterey initiative or sanctuary, including commercial and recreational fisheries whose viability depends on the health of the marine resources. Do you know if with regard to Monterey's experience, and I'm trying to get a benchmark really is what I'm trying to do, to find out if indeed similar goals have been met and what the impacts have been as far as you know in your capacity.
As far as exactly a numerical impact, the with the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary in the designation documents, the Monterey Bay Sanctuary specifically does not purport or does not explicitly take advantage of a National Marine Sanctuary's ability to regulate fisheries. It is in the National Marine Sanctuary Act that a sanctuary can regulate fisheries. The Monterey Bay Fishery, Monterey Bay Sanctuary designation documents strictly or expressly said that they will not regulate fisheries. That was what's often referred to as the promise. That's one of the main things that got the commercial fishing industry on board with that sanctuary and the communities up there as well that depend heavily on commercial fishing. Going to the point on page three here with item number nine, protect the economic health of the area, including commercial recreational fisheries. As I said earlier, that's been one of the rubs with the commercial fishing industry and the communities, is while the sanctuary, the Monterey Bay Sanctuary, hasn't specifically regulated fisheries, it certainly had a heavy hand in a lot of things that have affected the commercial fisheries, and that's where the rub comes, and that's where I think a lot of the mistrust has come from with the Monterey Bay Sanctuary and Channel Islands as well as some of the marine protected areas that were established. So that's one of the areas where the City of Morro Bay has gone on record and other organizations have gone, where it may not be a Monterey Bay or a sanctuary-specific thing, but it's really the Marine Sanctuaries Act that I think needed to be revisited and through the reauthorization process, and that's where one of the main rubs is.
Great. Okay. And I will not belabor this, Mr. Mayor. I just have a couple more questions. On page two, same document, could you, for my benefit, it says on the second paragraph, page two, same document, I'll let you get there. The Northern Chumash Tribe has teamed with local communities and organizations in a growing grassroots movement. These partners will be key contributors to the success of a proposed Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary. San Luis Obispo and Santa Barbara County communities want the Central Coast productive ocean waters to have the highest levels of protection for all generations. Establishment of a national marine sanctuary will preserve this special place and will add a distinctive treasure to the ONMS system. Can you cite for me specifically with regard to Morro Bay, the team and or outreach that has occurred with regard to the Chumash tribe in terms of what they describe as us being a key partner and contributor to success?
Morro Bay the city of?
Morro Bay specifically. So early on, Fred Collins, and when he was proposing this and bringing this, you know, starting to daylight it, so to speak, he did come to the city of Morro Bay, to representatives of the city, myself and a couple others, as well as the Commercial Fishermen's Organization. We brought our concerns, the same as I've expressed to you earlier, about commercial fishing impacts, harbor and dredging operation impacts. And the third, which I don't think I got to in my staff report, is the loss, you know, loss of local control being a national program. In those earlier talks, we met a couple times with Mr. Collins, and he did express that it would be his sanctuary's aim, if we were to be established, to carve around the commercial fishing, not regulate commercial fishing, and carve around the harbor so that those impacts would be minimized. In terms of specifics of that, we were working with Mr. Collins and trying to see if there's some sort of common ground that could be established, but we never got anything really on paper between the Commercial Fishermen's Organization and us and the city in terms of you know, real concrete proposals. I think it was all just discussion and talk.
Okay, great. One of the, and this is my last question, one of the most important potential future economic drivers for this community, in my mind, is the repurposing or reuse of the existing power plant. And by that, I do not mean the addition of anything that will contribute to the carbon footprint, but the opportunity to utilize the switch station and the grid to connect potential production and for the city to economically benefit greatly. Trident was mentioned earlier in open comment with regard to the issue and concern for birds, and I so noted that. Thank you very much for bringing that up. There is the potential for significant alternative energy development and use of our existing shuttered resource that could help and lead significantly to the preservation and economic viability of this community in the future. What's your sense of how this potential specific initiative, sanctuary, might have on the development of a significant number of what I will call windmill-type generating energy issues?
I would probably surmise it would be treated much like oil and gas development. It's an industrial development. Looking at the National Marine Sanctuary Act itself, prohibited activities, it's unlawful for any person to destroy, cause the loss of, or injure any sanctuary resource managed under law. If indeed these windmills, and what the degree is, I guess, is up to argument, but they do apparently take some birds out. And if resources, and if they're within the sanctuary boundaries, I would assume they'd be looked upon much the same way that oil and gas development would, that it's a take of marine resources, and therefore would be prohibited.
Fair. Thank you so much.
Thank you, John. Noah?
Yes, thank you. I'd just like to follow up on that specific point, and then I'll circle back to some of my other questions. But the way I understand it is there is some pretty clear language in the Sanctuary Act regarding specifics to oil and gas development. But then separately, particularly the one item I've seen is within Cordell, the Cordell Bank, allowing for the use of renewable energy systems, marine-related renewable energy systems, within a certain context and a heightened review process. That's the way I understand it and have read the documentation. So I think there is a difference the way the sanctuary designation would handle renewables versus oil and gas.
And it's quite possible an individual sanctuary designation, when those designation documents are being drawn up, with designation documents are basically the bylaws of the sanctuary and how it operates, much like the commercial fishing regulation, oversight or not, the sanctuary can pick and choose what under, with, as long as it falls within the National Marine Sanctuaries Act. You can't go sideways to the National Marine Sanctuaries Act, the overall, but it can pick and choose what sorts of things it wants to regulate or not.
Yeah, and I think you're kind of in a bit of an unfair position because I think all of us are coming up to speed on what is a very complicated proposal and management structure. The entire fishery is complex and has layers of regulation that you really need a map to be able to track, and then you've got to be able to refer back to that map to understand it. And it seems to always be changing. But the way I understand it, if you could confirm this, is where we're at in the process right now is we have a nomination that's been submitted to NOAA. At first, it was sent back for corrections and then recently accepted based on those corrections. And now we're in a window of what I understand to be 60 days for comments to be submitted related to that proposal or nomination.
Yeah, and maybe for the sake of clarity, so the NOAA, National Oceanographic and Atmospheric, opened up the nomination process, opened up the site selection list, which is basically an inventory of possible places to establish marine sanctuaries where there's support for them. They opened up that list back in 2014. There were several nominations submitted. Some were accepted, some were rejected, and a couple were withdrawn. The Chumash Heritage proposal was initially rejected, and basically the first rejection was just, is your application complete? Did you fill in all the blanks? Did you check all the boxes? Did you dot your I's and cross your T's? Their application wasn't deemed complete. It was kicked back. They resubmitted. It was deemed complete. Now it's under that 60-day review, you say, and the 60-day review looks at four different management criteria and seven different other considerations. The criteria are, does it meet one of four overarching National Marine Sanctuary designation sort of umbrellas? Is it a cultural heritage thing? Is it a natural resource thing? Is it a this thing? Is it a that thing? Does it meet one of those? And then it's got to meet all seven of these considerations, these management considerations, and that's a laundry list of different things from education and outreach and all the things you saw in the application, broad community support, protecting living resources, lots of different things that it needs to hit on. And NOAA is currently evaluating that, and that's that 60-day period that, in speaking to Bill Duros, the West Coast Regional Director for the Sanctuary Program, believes they're on schedule to be wrapped up with that about in October 4th or 5th, some 6th, somewhere through there.
Okay. I've heard that the County of San Luis Obispo, the Board of Supervisors, have asked for an extension on this so that they have time to submit their comments. Are you aware of anything like that?
No, it could be, but no, I'm not aware of that. I haven't heard that.
Okay. How hard and fast do you understand this 60-day window to be?
According to Mr. Duros, he said, I can't remember exactly what he said. He quipped some funny comment about somebody's birthday not being taken away or something. If it doesn't meet the 60-day window, it's a window that they try and meet. It's codified, but it's the National Marine Sanctuary Program doesn't go poof and disappear if they don't get it, if they don't make it. But he thought they were on track to meet that about 60-day October 5th window. But can they extend it? I suppose they certainly could, but I haven't heard that county requesting that.
Okay. And just to confirm, then, the way I understand the process from looking at the documents and some of my discussions is we're in the nomination period. NOAA will take all comments that they've received as well as the nomination themselves, review it based on the criteria, and then determine whether it's met the criteria and decide if it qualifies to be inventoried as a potential marine sanctuary. And at that point, it could sit in that inventory list, as many have, and some were just recently, that inventory list was recently cleared before it was again reopened. At some point, that inventory list and specific items on that list, like the local sanctuary proposal, could be pursued and developed in a designation phase, which would, as I understand it, include about 1 to 3 years of very intense public outreach, review with stakeholders to try to develop the details of what the sanctuary would be doing, what it would regulate, what it wouldn't, come up with the parameters unique to our area. That's one of the differences that I understand is that we see before us today is it is a unique nomination to our area rather than an expansion of the Monterey Sanctuary. At that point, then, NOAA would make a decision, a recommendation to Congress, and then it would take an act of Congress to approve. So am I somewhat correct on that?
Yeah, you're not somewhat correct. You're absolutely correct. Yeah, it takes an act of Congress. It's if it gets selected, if this proposal or any others get selected to get put on an inventory list, NOAA will have a list to go off of, and then at some future time, and there's it's a whole nother can of worms in terms of how NOAA goes about selecting off that list and when they can, that I won't go into now, but if they'll go off that list, and let's say there's 15 on there and they want to designate one or two New Amsterdam Marine Sanctuaries, they'll go through a process internally by which they'll pull off of that list and then start a public process that is probably not less than a year. I would guess probably more like 2 or 3 years where, you know, establishing those designation documents and, you know, those bylaws and really going through a very robust public process, like what Monterey did in Channel Islands and all the others. It was a very thorough public process across the board from state, local, federal, and taking all that public input into consideration.
And then, again, that's where the details of what a sanctuary would be doing could be defined. And listening to the Harbor Advisory Board, looking at understanding the historic concerns that have been raised, things like what sort of effect this could have on the local fishing, whether it's recreational or commercial, mariculture itself. We heard some strong concerns from our local oyster farmers, and I would strongly assume that would include the abalone farm and their kelp harvesting operation, our own personal harbor improvements and maintenance program, which we see in the comment letters from CMANC and are echoed in the previous resolution from 2012 that the city passed. Clearly, our water reclamation facility and the desalination plant would be potentially involved and determine how that could be affected and viewed within the sanctuary, the marine facility and boat haul out, and then the renewable energy. These are just some of the big issues that we know our community will need to be reviewing and very careful about what the sanctuary could affect. I'm sure there's more that I haven't mentioned, but how do you understand the city to be able to be at the table in that conversation and the different stakeholders that would be represented in some of those key items?
Well, obviously, one by staff tracking and keeping up on it and attending meetings. I think I wasn't involved with the Monterey Bay process, but my understanding it, you know, they have noticed meetings and they engage different stakeholder groups. I think you'd be pretty hard pressed to not get involved if you wanted to be. I don't think there's a chance that it comes and goes and you miss your chance. Oh, darn, how'd that happen? I didn't see that coming. I don't think there's that chance. I think it's a pretty robust engagement process.
All right, I would agree with you from what I've heard and just knowing the stakes of what this could mean. I think I'll go ahead and pass for now. Obviously, we'll have more questions later.
Thanks, Noah. John, I just have one brief question before I pass it on to Christine. Noah talked about the designation document. And to be clear, do you understand who drives the process? Is that Noah that's driving that, or is that the applicant? Do you know how that works?
I'm not intimately aware. Obviously, Noah's a big player in it, and obviously the proponent. They're not just going to nominate and then step back and watch it happen. Obviously, they need to step up and be a part of the process. But no, I'm not intimately aware of how exactly that works. I assume it's some sort of partnership between the two.
Okay. Thanks. Christine?
Yes, hi. Thank you, and thanks for everyone coming out on this topic tonight. Just a few questions. On August 5th, I believe there was a letter sent to the organizers of the Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary. So August 5th, that was the date, it looks to me, in a letter that I see to Fred Collins from NOAA, not Smuckler, but the federal organization, beginning the 60-day process. So I'm wondering if the city had a chance to see that letter. It just came to me recently. I hadn't been aware of it, but I'm wondering if we had that information around August 5th or so. I remember knowing, sent to me the initial application. I remember seeing the response, initial response from NOAA, that they had asked for more information. I don't remember seeing the August 5th letter circulated.
And I don't remember seeing that either. I do remember seeing the initial NOAA rejection letter that said you're deemed incomplete and here's some ideas to redo your application, but I don't recall seeing the second letter.
Okay. And the reason I mention it is because it's 60 days, not a very long time to get things through the process. And I'm just wondering if we had a chance to maybe talk about this a little bit sooner than, you know, shortly before the deadline. Second thing is, do you have any idea? I think I looked it up today. On November 12th, 2014, and this is just kind of a, can you, any idea what happened? And this could be something that maybe more than just Eric would be aware of. But on November 12th, I believe, 2014, so almost 10 months ago, council did request as a future agenda item, but it was a presentation that we had said we had hoped that the city would outreach to the group, the Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary, and have them come to the city and do a presentation for all of us, including the community. It wasn't going to be a council agenda item, so I think the record reflects in the minutes that there wasn't necessarily we didn't need to necessarily agree on whether we wanted to do it or not. So do you have any information on what's happened between the council requesting that just really basic community information from November 12 until now? Because it's been known that this has been in process for a while.
In terms of why, if part of your question is, are you asking why we didn't come back to council or why we never had that presentation?
Yes. Yeah, because I think it seems to me like on the November 12th, didn't have all the documentation. Certainly, we didn't have even probably one piece of paper in terms of the documentation we've received tonight. So I was just wondering, it seemed to me that given the interest in the city of Morro Bay on both sides and how diverse that support is on both sides, that I felt that we were really sort of ahead of it on November 12th by understanding that this was going to come forward at some point and knowing that we wanted to at least hear from those making the application in a very public way. So I'm just wondering if you have any sense of what happened, and it's a little disappointing when I realized, oh my gosh, we had been waiting for this for a while, the basic information on what was happening.
I don't recall specifically why we did or didn't move on that in terms of, and maybe I know Fred's out here in the audience. I don't know if he's going to have time as public comment, but I don't know if he can speak to that. It never got circled back to city council. I don't know if that was because the proponents weren't ready. It just didn't bubble to the top of importance. I can't say one way or another.
Okay, that's fine. Will there be presentations tonight from any groups other than the 3 minutes that everyone gets a public comment?
We didn't structure it that way, no. Didn't plan it that way.
Okay. And are there, based on your experience dealing with this over the years you've been in the city and well-versed on the history of it, could this National Marine Sanctuary designation move forward without the support of the city of Morro Bay?
It's going to be up to NOAA, and I don't know exactly who signs off on whether it gets on the inventory list. I know the Western Region and that office and the Western Regional Director, I'm sure, has a big part in it. It's NOAA staff, sanctuary staff, and maybe some folks out of the sanctuary in NOAA that review it and pass judgment on it. You know, one of the criteria is broad community-based support. If the city of Morro Bay continues to oppose, does that kill it? It's up to those evaluators and whether they look at the broader support, I suppose, with outside the county and everywhere else. And just, I'm assuming it's sort of a weighing project where they gauge the support and work from there.
And then do you have any feedback? I know in the report and through other information I've received from the Fishermen's Organization here and at Port St. Louis, we hear a lot about Monterey Bay and the fishermen's challenges there. And sometimes we've heard from the staff and the city staff there. Have we had anywhere any feedback from the other current sanctuaries like Channel Islands, Cordell Bank, Greater Farallones, Olympic Coast? The reason I ask specifically is Cordell Bank and Greater Farallones, and I'm not pronounced terribly butchering that Spanish word, they've just expanded. So I'm wondering, have we heard from them? Have you heard, sort of anecdotally, my understanding is they have a lot of political will support and, people who are elected by the people, just like we are, especially in the two counties around those two expansions. They've somehow managed to expand. So I'm just wondering if we've had any feedback from them.
You don't hear a lot from Cordell Bank and Gulf of the Farallones sanctuaries. Each sanctuary has its own superintendent, has its own sanctuary advisory council, and is operated independently, even though they operate under the National Marine Sanctuaries Act. You don't hear a lot coming out of those two sanctuaries. They don't surround harbors quite as much as Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary does. Monterey Bay Sanctuary is a word, and we hear it from the city of Monterey, Pillar Point, Santa Cruz, the same issues with the fisheries and with dredging and harbor maintenance and that sort of stuff. Channel Islands, not as much. More what you hear out of Channel Islands is from the commercial fishing industry, because that sanctuary is completely offshore around the islands, doesn't envelop any harbors, and really it just affects people out boating out on the waters out there in terms of regulatory authority. So mainly Channel Islands is fishery. And what the criticism from Channel Islands is primarily the marine protected area establishment in that sanctuary that was done with not the fishermen going along or the fishermen kicking and screaming along the way. So it was a process by which they weren't happy the way those were established.
Okay, when you say MPA, do you mean?
Marine protected area, sorry, marine reserve.
Okay, and then as far as Morro Bay goes, it's not necessary that the overlay from a potential national marine sanctuary would come into the bay. I've heard that doesn't necessarily.
Correct.
Doesn't mean they wouldn't, but it doesn't mean they will.
I mean, when a sanctuary is established, you through that whole public process, you determine where the boundaries are going to be. I think in the Chumash proposal, they proposed to and I call it a bubble. Create a bubble around the city of Morro Bay. I guess where that bubble is and what you can do inside and out becomes the critical factors. I don't know exactly where the boundaries are in Monterey. I know with their dredge disposal, they've got a very limited amount of area where they can dispose of their dredge materials, primarily because there's a prohibition in the National Marine Sanctuaries Act of establishing any new dredge disposal areas. So they're constrained by the limits of the sanctuary, and I think they're fairly close to the city, to the harbor there, but Santa Cruz as well, they're pretty well constrained. But no, I believe that in all those sanctuaries, the harbors themselves are not included, but exactly where the lines are, I couldn't tell you.
Okay. No, I understand. And I think it's challenging to ask questions that I know you don't exactly have the answer to, because we haven't had this item before us, and we certainly don't have all of the information, even in the staff report, that we've received over the last 3 or 4 days, including something we received, a working document that I hadn't seen until, really 2 hours ago, that was coming from the Harbor Department, from the Harbor Advisory Board. There was a document we got about 4 o'clock in the afternoon that kind of showed us their thought process, and, it was something that we didn't get a chance to see directly after their meeting. So I think that there's a lot of information that I've received in the last 48 hours, let alone 2 weeks, that I know, and I apologize, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I'm just sort of highlighting how much there is that we don't know coming into this tonight, and that isn't available for us here. One last thing, though, I do want a success that we had, you and I, Mr. Endersby, is we did find references to Appendix A and Municipal Code 1730060, and I wonder if you could just describe what those protections are. They're written into our municipal code and where they came from.
Yeah, certainly, and I'm certainly no expert on all things National Marine Sanctuary. Like all of us, we learn as we go. So a question was brought up, or the notion was brought up. Somebody recalled the county ordinance, a county measure A passed back in the 1980s, something had to do with prohibition of oil development, oil supporting facility development on county lands without the approval of the people. And in that research process, we found Morro Bay Municipal Code,
17.30.060.
Prohibition of new offshore oil development support facilities. So in the late 70s, early 80s, Bureau of Land Management was looking at opening up a large number of tracts off the coast here for oil development, and they were taking public input. The city of Morro Bay went on record with several letters in opposition. They called it a negative nomination or something along those lines, where for various reasons they opposed oil and gas development off our waters. We passed a resolution, or passed an ordinance, and then it changed with a resolution change, and it kind of changed over the years, but the ultimate result at the end of the day is 1730.060 of the Municipal Code, where it states there shall be no construction, reconstruction, operation, or maintenance of any commercial or industrial facility within the city, including but not limited to business or personnel office, oil or gas storage facilities, pipe, drilling materials, or equipment repair storage facilities, or any other aid or support which operates directly or indirectly in support of any offshore oil or gas exploration, development, drilling, pumping, blah, 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 blah. And then it refers to an Appendix A of the Municipal Code. And Appendix A, the purpose is stated as the purpose of this chapter is to prevent Morro Bay from becoming an oil port, personnel base center, or other logistical base for offshore oil operation. And then it made a bunch of findings consistent with what the county's measure had done and inconsistent with the city's general plan and housing element, and made lots of findings to say this is why we don't want to be an oil port.
Yeah, and thank you very much for finding that for me today. I've been looking for it for a while. And I guess a greater question that I know that you can't respond to, but the question that I would have on that is, you know, how strong of a prohibition is that? That's a municipal prohibition, and, it's in our municipal code, but it certainly, what kinds of things could change that, and what kinds of pressure could come down? I think that's a fair question to ask about our own protections here that we have in the city, and how strong are they moving forward into a very insecure energy future moving forward. Lastly, I will just reiterate some questions that I heard earlier. These are, in general, very quick list of questions I have about the Morro Bay's inclusion into a national marine sanctuary, and I'm just going to throw them out really quickly, and they're just questions that I know we don't have the answers to this evening. So basically, any kind of support or opposition. Well, let's put it this way. Here are the questions. We have a historic opposition to marine sanctuaries here. How do we manage that and ensure that the commercial fishing community has its concerns addressed? And how do we stay at the table to talk about those issues if this moves forward without our approval, but yet does move into the next phase? How do we ensure that our commercial fishing small businesses are represented to the larger group? So much negative feedback has been widely circulated in Morro Bay about the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary, and we hear that widely shared in our community. So what are some honest ways we can address those concerns as we've come forward, moving forward? And in balance, then, what are some reasons that we see other communities campaigning in some cases, or lobbying at least, to become a national marine sanctuary? And why? Why would they be doing that when we are hearing our neighbor to the north is unhappy? Historic drought in California has put pressure on us to turn on our desal. We're currently getting permits to potentially use that again and be ready to use it. Our state water supply, we 97% reliant on our state water. If those deliveries can't be achieved, then what kind of prohibitions would be on ocean outfall from a desalination plant here in Morro Bay? What kind of challenges may we have with the sanctuary status for desalination ocean outfall? Additionally, we've mentioned our largest infrastructure project, moving our aging wastewater treatment plant, moving it to an inland location. But certainly until we are fully accommodating our reclamation plan, which could be 5 to 7 years, where we would have full reclamation options, we are counting on, and we have discussed here in this chamber just recently, the ability to still use ocean outfall for our wet water flows. So I would be very curious to know how a sanctuary status would impact that. Power plant and Dynegy closing has opened ideas for other people to use the decommissioned transmission lines. So what's that, what does that mean for wave energy and wind energy in the sanctuary? What about our oysters? What about our bay? What about personal watercraft? What if they, this moves on without Morro Bay? And how protected are we from offshore drilling and gas? Those are my questions, none of which I know you can answer, but those are concerns I have moving forward, and thank you.
Thanks, Christine. And we can, before we move on to public comment, I just got one more note on here as we were going through some of the questions. Are there other local, other communities that have, as I look at the same item that Councilmember Heading brought up as far as teamed with local communities, do you have any other local communities that have supported this so far?
I'm not aware of any that have. I believe it went to the Board of Supervisors last week, but they asked for more thorough staff analysis of it. So I don't think the Board of Supervisors is weighed in. I'm not aware of any other communities. The Port San Luis Harbor District, back in June, voted to oppose, continue their opposition stance, much like Morro Bay's, very similar resolution. And that was back in June.
Okay, great. Noah?
Yes, there's one more item that it's been mentioned that we've received a lot of correspondence over the last 48 hours. One that I think somewhat begins to answer Mr. Heading's questions about what the sanctuary has accomplished or the effects of the sanctuary within the different sanctuaries on the West Coast. And we did receive today correspondence from NOAA and Mr. Dueros, the regional director for the West Coast, a document that I believe has been introduced to the public record and should be referred to, titled Collaborations with Fishermen and the West Coast National Marine Sanctuaries. So I've been using that as a way to give a quick review of what some of the more positive effects of a sanctuary designation has created, and it's broken down amongst all the different sanctuaries in a bullet point presentation. So I would definitely refer people there if they're interested in getting some better information about your specific question.
Great. And with that, as we go into public comment, looking at the crowd, we could have in estimations of an hour and a half or so public comment. So I would just ask that you be succinct and get through your comments as quickly as possible. If you go past the 3 minutes, I'm going to encourage you to conclude, and please don't take offense to that, but I'm going to try to keep the pace going. So with that, I'll open public comment for this item. Please come forward, state your name.
Hello, Mr. Mayor. Hello, council. Hello, staff. My name is David Georgi. I am from Shell Beach. I'd like to have a few things to say to you tonight about the sanctuary. The oil drilling moratorium ends in 2017. We have the oil companies just waiting to go for this. You know they're going to get it if we don't protect it. A national marine sanctuary is the only way to protect our oceans permanently. It appears that the oil industry has been orchestrating opposition against the sanctuary. I've noticed going to a number of meetings recently, the same sound bites come up that are basically misinformed and fearful. For example, at the last meeting of the Harbor Advisory Board, somebody mentioned that, the sanctuary doesn't have any supporters. There's hardly anyone here. Well, I want you to see the supporters that we do have. And this is a list. Of over 600 individuals, elected officials, organizations, local businesses that have signed the petition. And I have a copy of the list here for you. You could probably add to this list anyone who saw the TV series Big Blue Live on PBS in the first three nights of this month. The BBC wanted to do a story about a miracle of nature. They can go anywhere in the world to do this, and they decided to go to the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary. They spent 4 months filming it. It's beautiful. It's extremely well done. They interviewed many of the business owners who depend upon a clean ocean and a healthy ecosystem. They'd interviewed many of the scientists that work there, by the way. The National Marine Sanctuary up at Monterey Bay has 25 marine research stations that generate over $200 million a year. All 14 National Marine Sanctuaries generate $4 billion a year. This is something that you guys need to think about here in Morro Bay. This is something that you need to think about to get your name on that list. I would encourage you to actually see that show if you haven't seen it. It's being streamed on PBS, and you can also buy a DVD if you want. The third episode is just really wonderful. The Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary would permanently protect an area that is unique. Each National Marine Sanctuary has to make a case that it is unique. We are unique not only because of the archaeological sites beneath and above the ocean from the Chumash Nation, it's also unique because we have species of wildlife, fish, birds, all kinds of stuff, that congregate off our waters that are northern species and southern species. They meet here together in our area. So that makes it a perfect area for wildlife research.
Can I have to ask you to conclude?
And I will conclude by saying the other major thing that we're unique about is we have currents going north and south. We have air currents going north and south. They converge here in our area, which makes it a perfect area to study climate change.
Thank you.
Who do I give this to?
Right here.
Good evening. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak. I am Carol Georgie, representing the San Luis Obispo chapter of the Surf Rider Foundation. I live in Pismo Beach, sometimes known as Shell Beach. The sanctuary process has changed, as your councilman, Noah, has been explaining. Nomination is not the same thing as designation. Designation occurs as a separate process that by law is highly public and participatory and often takes several years to complete. And that's basically why we didn't reach out to all cities in both counties, because that process is next. Part one of the National Marine Sanctuary process begins with a group of people writing a new National Marine Sanctuary as designed by NOAA's new list of wanting a grassroots effort. As part of the writing team for the proposed Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary, the Surf Rider Foundation worked with other local groups so that first, the proposed sanctuary will not include harbors. Harbors will retain their local control. The proposed sanctuary will not add additional fishing regulations. For example, the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary has never passed a regulation restricting fishing. Every sanctuary designation is different, and there are 14 marine sanctuaries. They are like national parks, like having a Yosemite of the sea. The proposed sanctuary will provide comprehensive ecosystem-based management of the offshore ocean area, and the proposed sanctuary will prohibit new offshore oil drilling. As we've just heard, the temporary moratorium to protect offshore oil drilling ends in 2017. That means we would lose the protection of the coast coming from oil spills. Supporting a new National Marine Sanctuary is the only way to have local control prohibiting new offshore oil drilling. Parts 2, 3, and 4 are turning the document in and having NOAA review it. Part 6 Part 5 is whether or not NOAA accepts the application. And as Mr. Noah Smuckler just said, it becomes on a list. This area was on a list starting in 1990 for a marine sanctuary. It was even a bill twice in Congress, but it did not leave committee. So lobbying stopped this area from becoming a marine sanctuary. And then a year or two after that, Monterey Bay became the sanctuary, and they actually took part of the same proposed area for their sanctuary. So it goes on an inventory. So the nomination process does not result in designation. Future designation is a separate lengthy discussion between NOAA and all of the stakeholders in the sanctuary area. Think about the possibilities for the city of Morro Bay. This is the new exploration center.
Please wrap it up, please. Thank you.
And Santa Cruz, this is the $10 million office structure, classrooms, and offices for the Channel Islands Natural Marine Sanctuary on campus at University of California. And do you want these?
Thanks. Please submit them. Folks, I'm going to have to, we're starting to run over, and there, oftentimes we'll kind of allow some flexibility on time, but there, since there is so many people speaking, I'd like to, everybody have the chance to talk. So at the three-minute mark, please conclude your remarks. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, you may want to suggest they keep their eye on the light because it says yellow and red.
Thank you. Thanks.
Liz Gilson, Morro Bay Chamber of Commerce, Director of Operations. We, as the Chamber of Commerce, support our local member businesses, and we ask that you consider how you vote, how your vote will affect their future. We ask that the council continues to oppose the Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary nomination so that there is more time for all involved to consider the possible negative impact that this designation will have on our local fishing industry, agriculture, and economy in general before a final designation is made. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz.
Hi, my name is Lori French from Morro Bay, and I'm going to put a little thing over here where Nancy is.
Thanks, Nancy.
You can laugh at this, but this was this weekend. This was put out by NOAA. Notice it says Morro Bay was negative 328 degrees this weekend. Could you switch? That was on September 18th. This is NOAA weather, your federal government. On September 20th, we were still negative 328 degrees, but we upgraded now because we have a wind chill factor of 396 degrees. I have a point. Another branch of NOAA contacted my husband and myself for a transaction we did. They contacted us in January of 2015 about a transaction we did in 2001. Does anybody see where I'm going with this? I really don't trust NOAA and their management system to be on task and up to speed. I think local control is better. That's point one. My concerns are, a sanctuary means no fishing zones. We already have the national, or the Monterey National Marine Sanctuary, and we've learned from this. It may not be the marine sanctuary itself that's saying no fishing, but their tentacles are going out and putting in the marine protected areas. We already have 27 areas in place that are heavily restricted here on the local central coast. I don't know the exact acreage, but it is vast. 27. We don't need another one. My next point is the harbor mouth dredging. Commercial fishermen have already fought to ensure that this harbor mouth gets dredged and is safe for everyone. Everyone. The National Marine Sanctuary requires spoil removal permits, which translates to added time and added cost, which could very well lead to more lives lost. This is something I'm very adamant about, and that should be on the top of our list. Let's switch to the local farming scene. As a small avocado rancher, the paperwork for the Central Coast Water Quality Control Board is onerous right now. The Central Coast Water Quality Control Board came out, another little tentacle of the Monterey Bay Marine Sanctuary. This proposal will add another layer, thus taking a toll on farmers and ranchers with water runoff issues. And if you don't think that will happen, I will happily give you all my water reports, and you can fill them out, because I'm kind of done with it. I'm over it, and you can have a taste of avocado ranching. Yes, I heard. And as for job creation, I'll be very quick. I would like everybody to stand up in the audience who has something to do with commercial fishing, farming, or businesses where we spend money. This is just a small portion because many of our fleet is gone.
Thanks, Lori.
Okay.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Good evening, Mayor Irons and Council. My name is Steve Reebuck. I live in San Luis Obispo now, but I had the great good fortune to grow up in Morro Bay. My family moved here in 1955 to fish abalone and albacore, and I'm actually the first lifeguard that was ever hired by the city. I'm opposed to the Marine Sanctuary and for these reasons. First, we're told we need the National Marine Sanctuary to stop any offshore oil development. Well, as we heard from Mr. Ellisby earlier, Measure A was passed in 1986, and you'll see it's my first exhibit there. By the way, these documents are for the record. This plan that I provided for you came out of the county's local coastal plan, which is equivalent to the Coastal Act, so very strong document. Measure A was passed by the voters of this county, and what it says is that there can not be any land-based operations in support of offshore oil without a vote of the people. Well, this law was passed in 86, has been in place now for 29 years. Seems to be working. Now, the second point that I would like to make is, my second exhibit there, are the network of marine sanctuaries that have been developed by the state of California. And my count is roughly 24 from basically Monterey down to Point Conception. My point being that there's a tremendous amount of protection already on this coast. And if you look at the regulatory agencies like NOAA, National Marine Fisheries, or also under the Department of Commerce, Department of Fish and Wildlife, and other agencies, got a lot of protection. Pacific Council is another one. So I'd like you to see on those maps that we already have some closed areas for fishing. We have some that are conservation zones, so that some limited fishing can take place. Lastly, I'd like to point out, I think Mr. Ellersby said that you could have 2 or 3 years of the process of developing the National Marine Sanctuary. That means that cities and counties are going to have to dedicate staff time to this process. It's going to cost the city money to pay for this with no end in sight. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Reebuck.
Richard Scangarello, live in Shell Beach. I'm not nearly as prepared as everybody else. A couple of things that I've noticed over my years of experience in life. Generally, when bureaucrats and elected officials get involved, it never gets less expensive and it never gets more efficient. With respect. The other thing is I've learned by listening that you're considering to vote on something that you don't have all the information on. It sounds like a famous quote from a famous senator from California. You'll have to read the bill to know what's in it, or you'll have to pass the bill to know what's in it. Nancy Pelosi. Okay. That's it.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Brad Snook. I'm the co-chair of our county's chapter of the Surfrider Foundation. I appreciate the focus on respect. When this thing boils down, it's not a contentious issue because some of the planning that's gone into this these documents and the planning that's gone into the Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary up to this point has led us to a significant ground being covered in the last 3 years since the council pass this resolution. So it's a great opportunity for the council to look at right now where they're at and take kind of the changes in tide and the information that's being brought to you by the Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary supporters and say, yes, we do have a potential for a National Marine Sanctuary in our county waters. And here are the issues that Morro Bay would like to be resolved in order to show that we can support the sanctuary. The sanctuary supporters already said that they will not regulate fishing, that they will not regulate ports. Are you willing to take them at their word, or are you just going to believe, based on conjecture, that that is not true? If you are not going to believe that that is not true, how are you going to put that in the resolution? So I suppose what you should do is you should start off with a comment about oil and gas and prohibiting or restricting that, and then take a shot at what you can support to make the sanctuary happen. Whereas that, there are many, many issues we are finding out in the community. People coming out of the woodwork. Hey, what about our personal watercraft? What about tow and surfing? Saw that in Monterey Bay as well. Those are all issues that can be resolved. And I thank the council for hearing this tonight.
Thank you, Brad.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. My name is Doug Tate. I am here to speak in favor of the Chumash Marine Sanctuary. I'm also the conservation chair for Morro Coast Audubon, and I'm speaking tonight on their behalf. I hope you've had a chance to read our letter supporting this sanctuary, and I hope you're aware of the scientific and environmental benefits of a national marine sanctuary, and they're considerate. Now there are economic benefits coming out in reports and documents. And just for an example, the 2009 report from Australia noting the boost to ecotourism and the spillover for fisheries from healthy marine sanctuaries into surrounding waters. The 2015 NOAA report finding significant economic benefits of recreational fishing in California's four national marine sanctuaries. And the 2014 report pointing to the economic benefits of a Central Coast National Marine Sanctuary. If you, as others have questioned this by Dr. Scorsese and Dr. Keldo, please carefully review their response to the sanctuary opponents who are questioning the economic benefits of this sanctuary. And that can be found in September 4th Tribune, and I think it's in your staff report also. I would briefly like to respond to your Harbor Advisory Board's question, what things the sanctuary is proposing to protect that aren't already receiving adequate protection. We believe what is currently not receiving adequate protection is possibly the fishing industry's worst case scenario, an oil spill that could shut down the fisheries for an extended length of time. A National Marine Sanctuary's prohibition against offshore oil is permanent, not subject to politics, and cannot be lifted by future administrations. The creation of a marine sanctuary is the best and the only way to keep offshore oil off our coast. Sanctuary status will also enhance the coordination of scientific research relating to changing marine ecosystems. This is clearly important today with increased ocean acidification, warming waters, disruptions in the food chain, and the decline of marine vertebrate populations. When a sanctuary protects the ocean resources, that goes hand in hand. That is, it protects our ocean-based livelihoods also. We completely understand that the fishing community wants to protect their livelihoods. We get that. But we also get that a clean, environmentally sound ocean is necessary not only to sustain the fishing industry, but also to sustain the many ocean tourist-related businesses here in Morro Bay, Cambria, Cayucas, and up and down our central coast. So these are some of the things the sanctuary will protect from a changing political future. It will also protect our ocean and keep it healthy, which benefits all species, including us who depend on it. Thank
you. I'm going to have to ask you to conclude. Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you for submitting your letter.
Good evening. My name is Javi Cajon. I'm going to have to ask Nancy to get ready for a video. I'm here representing the San Luis chapter of the Surf Riders also, which supports the concept of clean oceans by encouraging the founding of a marine sanctuary on our coast. I would like to show a two-minute video as a positive note of what could be considered as an addition to our coast. Tourists are seeing the wildlife will be coming back to our coast, as in the recent PBS special on Monterey Bay Sanctuary. Now let's have a short glimpse of the positive effects to our other sanctuary communities that have resources such as ours.
If we can get some other public comment going and come back to that, just to keep things moving. Okay, good. And sir, could we get your name again? I didn't quite hear your name.
Javi Cajon. Should I spell it?
Thank you. Next for public comment, please come forward. If there's any other video or material, please let Nancy know. Thank you.
That's going to be a hard act to follow. My name is Sandra Rakestraw. I live in Atascadero. I am a retired board certified forensic toxicologist who made my first home in Morro Bay in 1974. From our home on Juniper Street, I could watch the ocean, and after a number of years viewing, became an advanced open water certified scuba diver. Therefore, I am familiar with both science as well as the ocean. We currently dive in the waters of the Pacific, the Atlantic, and the Caribbean. Without a doubt, open waters that are within the National Marine Sanctuaries contain the healthiest, most abundant, varietal, and largest sea life to be found. These protected areas encourage undisturbed growth and uninterrupted replacement of the sea life and the environment which live within. The establishment of this sanctuary would be a golden opportunity to further protect our coastline. Who besides NOAA has the most recent, comprehensive, and predictive information on the ocean, including our local areas? Is there anybody local who can adequately prevent, address, or respond to marine emergencies or issues such as land runoff, open water contamination, or other unforeseen aquatic disasters, as NOAA could do? How well your support of this preserve would speak to the public about your seriousness in addressing the threats of ocean warming, ocean acidification, loss of species, and underwater habitat destruction. We cannot ignore these issues currently in our face or wish them away. Therefore, Are we professionally ask you to please look to the future of all the local oceans, especially our local ocean, accept the support as well of all the economic advantages and prestige of a national marine sanctuary right here in Morro Bay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Ladies, gentlemen, I'm Janet Miggins. I am a resident of Morro Bay, seem to be in a small minority here tonight, but I support the Chumash Marine National Reserve, and I do vote.
Thank you.
My name is Robert Davis, and I live in Morro Bay. One of the supporting documents for the sanctuary is called the Potential Economic Impacts, prepared by Jason Scorsi and Judith Kildow. One of the things that they say the sanctuary will do will be to create 16 new government jobs to administer the sanctuary. To me, that's not job creation. That's an expenditure of taxes to create new positions to write more regulations. That's not an economic benefit. They also say that there will be money raised by local NGOs and academics to conduct sanctuary-related research. Dr. Scorsi and Dr. Kildow say they have no data to support this contention. They do state that outside funding in the Monterey Bay region comes from the Monterey Bay Aquarium. We don't have an aquarium in Morro Bay. They talk about increased coastal tourism as an economic benefit. We spend through our tourism bureau and our county TMD more than $1 million a year to increase tourism. Dr. Scorsi and Dr. Kildow state that they cannot draw a clear link between sanctuary policies and increased tourism. We can. We had an increase of 16% in tourism this past year. And we don't need a sanctuary designation to support that. They state that increased property values and property taxes will result from the proximity of a sanctuary. Further stating that property values would likely decrease if oil and gas rigs were built offshore. They also state that there are currently no proposed permits for offshore drilling. Telling people that their home is next to a marine sanctuary is not likely to add value. We add value by providing outdoor activities that attract people to Morro Bay: surfing, fishing, swimming, bicycling, and boating. Let me quote from the staff report. It is important to emphasize that just because we are not able to estimate economic values for the potential benefits of sanctuary designation does not mean that they do not exist. It just means that the research and data don't exist to provide hard numbers. May I suggest that they don't exist because they don't exist? Thank you.
Thank you, Red.
Good evening, members of council and staff. My name is Rick Deschler.
Thank you, Rick.
In the late 1970s, I worked on a boat that did sparking and darting for oil exploration off our coast. In the mid-1980s, when I first served on the Harbor Board, I clearly remember reviewing the plans for offshore oil support base in Morro Bay. That was scrubbed, and we had been free of the threats of oil production for 3 decades. Now, the national and state perspectives are changing. It could happen before you could react. The only way you can protect Morro Bay's coast with restrictions on oil and gas development is with a national marine sanctuary. The illusion of local control will not stop oil and gas development once approved by the state or federal governments. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good
Good evening, Mayor Irons and council members. I am Andrew Christie, director of the Santa Lucia chapter of the Sierra Club, speaking on behalf of the Sierra Club's 2,000 members in San Luis Obispo County. Last fall, the Sierra Club asked Dr. Jason Scorse and Dr. Judith Kildow to undertake a study of the potential economic impacts of a national marine sanctuary on the Central Coast. Sanctuary opponents refer to this as a The Sierra Club study to convey the impression that we wrote it, but we did not. Dr. Scorse is the director of the Center for the Blue Economy at the Middlebury Institute of International Studies at Monterey. Dr. Kildow is director of the Center's National Ocean Economics Program. They studied several decades of data from national marine sanctuaries to the north and south of us, as well as data never before available to researchers. They used standard economic models based on conservative assumptions. Their report concluded that a national marine sanctuary on the Central Coast would likely result in, at a minimum, $23 million annually in new economic activity and up to 600 new jobs. Sanctuary opponents have tried to discredit these findings, as you just heard. They failed. All of their testimony, op-eds, and letters to the editor are based on a single opinion piece. Its author is not an economist, and her critique was based on a fundamental error and misunderstanding. She assumed that a national marine sanctuary would regulate fishing and that the authors of the economic study had therefore erred by omitting the potential cost of regulations. When it was pointed out to her that the National Marine Sanctuary Program does not issue fishing regulations and that the proposal for a Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary specifically states that it will not do so, and hence the study was correct not to calculate such costs because there will be no such costs, she admitted her mistake. Thus, the conclusions of the economic study stand and have been met with no credible challenge, which means if you vote tonight to oppose the sanctuary nomination, you will be voting against the likely addition of millions of dollars and a significant number of jobs to the regional economy. You have an opportunity to break with the past and the tradition of reflexive opposition established by your predecessors. Those council majorities manifested a lack of vision and concern for the future in virtually every major decision they made during their tenure. That's why they're no longer here, and you are. Recently, the people of Marin and Sonoma County succeeded in expanding the national marine sanctuaries they already have off their coast. They knew what they're doing. We think you know that the concerns you're hearing tonight and have been hearing for many years are anecdotal, subjective opinion, or distortions of reality. The data is not controversial. The facts are clear. The Chumash Heritage National Marine Sanctuary would be, offshore and onshore, the best single thing to happen to the Central Coast, including Morro Bay, in any of our lifetimes. We would urge you to go on record in favor of it, and I have a handout. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. Jim Hausner, I'm the executive director of the California Marine Affairs and Navigation Conference that was referenced earlier during your question period. And our position on the National Marine Sanctuary Program is here. Not speaking in favor or opposed to the National Marine Sanctuary Program. I don't know if folks know it, but back in the days when Jim Funk used to work for you, I was the assistant harbor master up at Pillar Point Harbor, and so have some experience in that. You got our paper, but I'd like to comment one of the things that happens, and we're in California. We have open government. Everything we do is done in front of the public. The federal rulemaking process is not. We're all allowed to comment. We're allowed to talk. But at the end of the day, they go back to Washington and develop their rules and develop their designation documents. And that's one of the things you really have to worry about is how do you make sure that what is told to you now is something the federal government will live up to as they move forward. The other part, and I don't know exactly what happened up in the state of Oregon, but I did serve on the West Coast Governor's Agreement on Ocean Health, and it was one of their 9 technical advisory committee chairs. And Oregon, I think, is far ahead of California in terms of valuing their ocean and their resource. They've passed on a National Marine Sanctuary Program in Oregon, I believe back in May or June. And it would be interesting to find out exactly why they took care of that. With regard to the harbor issue, it's not the dredging per se or that they come into the harbor. It's what do you do with the sediment after you dredge it. The sanctuary in Monterey has a rulemaking as part of their designation document that grandfathered existing dredging and dredge material placement. Well, grandfathered was same place, same time, same location. It actually prohibits dredged material placement. So City of Monterey had to dredge their harbor. They actually had to do it upland outside. They dredged the harbor, fine, because that's not inside the sanctuary. But when it came time to place the material, they had to place it further up the beach outside of the sanctuary jurisdiction at additional cost. Pillar Point Harbor dredged their launch ramp, got a 2013 permit from the Coastal Commission, could not put the material back into the sanctuary, and had very difficult times dealing with that. You can take clean sand and put it in the sanctuary, but because you dredged it, you cannot put it back in the sanctuary. I think that would take care of the other thing, PWCs. The sanctuary, again, Monterey Bay, can regulate vessels. Currently, they're only regulating PWCs, but court cases held that they actually have the ability to regulate vessels throughout and be interesting. In terms of the fishing, though, I could just make one comment. The National Marine Sanctuary, the Monterey Sanctuary folks, did go talk to the Pacific Coast Fisheries Council about creating marine protected areas within that sanctuary as a way to regulate fishing. They were trying to get around that, and they actually were moving ahead. According to documents, they were very active in the creation of the California Marine Protected Act areas and believed that they got what they wanted through that process. And I'll stop right there. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jim. Thanks for coming out.
I'm short. Hi, I'm Shush Kratzer from Morro Bay. I've lived in Morro Bay for over 26 years, and during this time we've been a strong proponent of having our coastline protected as a National Marine Sanctuary. Everyone who lives here and those who visit here want this wonderful oceanfront community to thrive with a sustainable local fishery, clean water, and protection from future oil drilling and seismic surveys, etc. We want our grandchildren to continue to enjoy this area. That's all of our goals. So we need to remember that we're all trying to approach this from the same perspective. The disastrous oil spill in Santa Barbara could absolutely happen here. There's no doubt about it. If any of you have been to Santa Barbara lately, you can still see what's going on there. Talk about protecting fishing. You've got to stop the oil. And as you can hear from so many people, the only way to stop oil drilling here is with a National Marine Sanctuary. In the past, the past votes the council has taken, the expansion of the Monterey Sanctuary to our shores was criticized because it would not be locally controlled. So now we have this local sanctuary proposed. The records show that advisory councils for present sanctuaries have a profound impact on how they're managed, and this is something that's really important to hear. There are factual ways to see how these have impact. It's not just hearsay. You can look and see, and it's been shown that 90% of the time, advisory councils are listened to and what they're recommending has been accepted. And for the newest one, the Farallon one, 99% of the time, advisory council has been listened to and what they propose is accepted. It doesn't get any better than this, and it never will. You can't find more local control than that. This vote tonight does not automatically create this sanctuary, and this is important for everybody to realize. All it does is allow us to continue the process, and to not be on the table for this process, I think, is an embarrassment for our city. It's not just a Morro Bay sanctuary. This is the entire Central Coast. Monterey has one. Channel Islands has one. Our Central Coast, we're trying to connect that. NOAA's trying to propose, they've asked us to do this for years, for 25 years it's been discussed. Anytime you've had questions, Lois Capps has been available. All the questions that you guys have asked tonight, I've read today online. They've been available for months. And some of the things have been available for years. This is not a new issue. And also, I was somewhat disappointed today to hear all the negatives about the proposal and nothing about the positives.
I'm going to have to ask you to conclude, Shush.
Okay.
Thank you. Appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Mayor, Council, and staff. I'm Jesse Barrios. I'm here. I'm a good portion of my family has been in the Central Coast since before California was a state or even a U.S. territory. And I have direct lineage to the Chumash tribe and Mission Indians tribe. And I find it particularly offensive that they would call this a Chumash heritage sanctuary. And the concept of handing over federal control or handing over control of our local natural resources to a federal agency, I find that particularly offensive to the whole Native American history of the area. And then I look, many of the people here are talking about the benefits of handing it all over to NOAA, and NOAA can react quickly, and NOAA can stop marine drilling and exploration. But I think the entire concept of a local government or even state government is compromised when we automatically just give it to Washington, give it to NOAA to take control. I'm a commercial fisherman right now. The California state, Sacramento, controls a majority of our fishing regulations. And although there's a lot of ambiguity and complexity with the laws and how does it apply to each fishery, at least we have the ability to communicate on even a low level. The majority of the fishermen here, we have local game wardens, we have their cell phone numbers, we have their personal numbers. A lot of the wardens give us their personal numbers. If something happens, if there's, say, for instance, we find someone's lost gear, or we see something, you know, a hurt animal or whatever, we can call a game warden right then and say, hey, here's what's going on. And we have a great line of communication with Sacramento, and we have the ability, when new regulations are proposed, to go and petition or at least be a part of the hearings. I just have a real problem giving this all over to NOAA, federal government. We lose our local control, we lose our local input. And although many of the intentions of the sanctuary are great, I understand the environmental part, I understand economic part, I understand that a lot of the intentions are very honorable, the unintended consequences, I think, are much greater problem, that once we give them control, we never get that back. And as a local board, a local council, I think it's within your best interest to say, to really make sure you do have a strong input. I think it's necessary to oppose this now. We heard multiple questions for the gentleman right here, and he didn't have the answers to what the sanctuary will, what about this, what about this. There are a lot of answers he didn't have. And I think before the council can actually endorse a sanctuary proposal, I think a lot of those questions need to be addressed. And as far as the no fishery, as far as the federal government not having control of fisheries, that's not true. At any time, they can change that. And then at what point are we able to fight that? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for coming forward.
Thank you. My name is Brad Wilcox. I grew up in Morro Bay here. Actually worked for the Harbor Department as a lifeguard for a couple years. Currently a commercial fisherman out of this port. I've heard lots of opinions and assumptions tonight, so I'll be quick. I just wanted to give mine. I've heard over and over again that it's impossible to regulate offshore drilling with anything but a National Marine Sanctuary. That's clearly not true because the moratorium in place has kept that from happening for the past 20 years. So I'd like people to have faith that there is other ways that we can do this. As far as economic benefits that they say will come from the sanctuary, you know, I don't think that, you know, filming blue, you know, beautiful movies and doing science in our ocean is really a problem. We don't need a sanctuary to do that. I don't think without a sanctuary you're going to find a whole lot of opposition there. So those economic benefits, the ocean is beautiful out there. We're out there every day. A lot of the people that you heard from tonight aren't, and it's beautiful. Yes, there's whales, there's everything. The protections in place are working. So I just would like to, you know, let Morro Bay know that you have confidence in what has happened, and maybe we should just continue to do what we have done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Council, Mayor. Tom Hafer, commercial fisherman. A couple of answers. We have 209 miles of reserves and from Pigeon Point to Point Conception. We have a lot of research going on right now with Cal Poly, Sea Grant. I've been doing research here for the last 15 years. in the near shore. It doesn't take a sanctuary to do research. Cal Poly's been involved in forever doing it. We have a big project coming up here the 28th. Cal Poly has a huge, huge facility at the pier, at the college, Dean Witt, Roy Nakamura, all these, you know, so we got that covered, I think. We don't need a sanctuary for that. And the protection part of it, you've heard, we have MPAs. We have rules and regulations. We have a clean ocean. I don't know why everybody thinks if there's a sanctuary here, the fish are going to come here. That's ridiculous. I don't even know what they're thinking there. Just because there's a line at Cambria, is that why all the whales are up there right now? No, it's not. It's because of all the baits up there. A sanctuary isn't going to bring more fish, more whales, more tourists, more money. What we're going to be paying money for, that $26 million that Andrew Christie said the sanctuary is going to make, is going to be from permits from dredging, fishing, all this stuff that nobody's even thinking about. That's where all that money comes from. We're going to have to take their spoilage out 12 miles and dump them. That's going to cost millions of dollars for that dredge to come here. So, you know, you can't trust the government. No matter what they say, I don't know. I don't get it. I don't think we need a sanctuary. We have plenty of protection. And I hope the council sees it that way. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Yeah, Butch Powers, president of Port San Luis Fishermen's Association. And I'd like to tell you, say a few things about misconceptions here. I spend meetings with Fish and Game. I just got out of meetings with Fish and Game and also Monterey Bay Sanctuary people. And right now, they're pushing right down our throat right now up at Point Surf for 100 square miles to take away from the fishermen right now. And I've been at these meetings. So you can't tell me that's not going to disrupt our fishing. So I want you folks to know that. And also, I had a meeting a few weeks ago with the San Ynez Chumash Indians. They're appalled that their name is even on this thing, according to these people. They say the Northern Chumash doesn't even exist. Now, I don't know if Fred Collins can come up with paperwork and documents to say there is a Northern Chumash tribe, but these tribes are saying no. The Selenians say they never got past Chumash never got past Morro Bay. So the Indians are in a turmoil over this whole situation, just to clear that up. And because I went to talk to them and see where they stood. So there's a lot of misconceptions here. And the environmental groups here really got a lot of facts wrong. They don't really go to Fish and Game meetings and talk to see what's going on in the fish industry. So where we're at is kind of like back in the old days where the owl and the loggers and to put millions of dollars out and cause millions of problems. And this ocean out here is kind of like the owl right now with the environmental groups. They want it no matter what. They would just as soon get run over by a truck if that would give them the marine sanctuary. So they're pretty fanatical, and they really don't know their facts 100%. They know a few facts. I'm not going to dispute that. But I'm at meetings after meetings and after meetings with the fishing game and stuff, and I really know what the facts are because that's my job as president of the Fishermen's Association. So I want you folks to know that. It would be a huge mistake for you to, if Morro Bay becomes a marine sanctuary, the decision, if it comes out of you tonight, is going to go up and down the whole coast. It's just going to ring a bell between every fisherman from San Diego to the Oregon border. It's just going to ring a bell, and that's not a good thing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Mayor, City Council members. My name is PJ Webb. I've been a volunteer community advocate for this region for over a decade. I'm an attorney, and I work on marine policy. This is a topic I know well, and I must in good conscience speak out about it. The community process to pursue National Marine Sanctuary protection has been stalled for very long. There is a new opportunity that has been opened up to begin a dialogue. So what's the worst thing that can happen to a fishing community? No, it's not a sanctuary. Not a sanctuary that passes no regulations restricting fishing. Not a sanctuary that protects the ecosystem and habitat that the fish thrive in. Not a sanctuary that encourages multiple uses with public access for all, recreation, commercial, and fishing, and it's free to all. By the way, there's no charge for a permit for anything that you need a permit for, and that includes dredging for the harbors. There are no charges for the permits for National Marine Sanctuaries. So what's the worst thing if it's not a National Marine Sanctuary? It's an oil spill. Ask the Gulf of Mexico fishing communities ruined by massive oil spills. Ask the fishermen off Refugio Beach where offshore oil spilled into the ocean while being piped to an onshore refinery. Do you remember the Wizard of Oz? Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. This is about offshore oil drilling. All over this country, in communities that dare question the safety of offshore oil drilling and development, the campaign starts up. Throw up enough smoke, mud, mirrors, derail the conversation. Truth, there is no local control over fishing regulation. That is controlled by state and federal fisheries management, not National Marine Sanctuaries. Truth, there is no local control over offshore oil development, and we are not protected from offshore oil drilling. The temporary moratorium that was just mentioned was a 5-year moratorium. It ends in 2017, and that's 2 years. Measure A will not keep land-based development from occurring somewhere else to help sustain offshore oil drilling development. These are peripheral issues, not about having a National Marine Sanctuary. They are issues about derailing a discussion by all regional residents and stakeholders about the importance of whether we want a tool like the National Marine Sanctuary Program to protect us from offshore oil drilling. Allow our communities to engage in this. This is a long process. If you're willing to let the interests of oil development overcome the protection of our communities, our marine life, and our economic growth, go ahead, oppose the proposal and cut off the discussion. This is how bullies win. But let's keep the conversation going and not end it. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you, PJ.
Thank you for the discussion.
Good evening, Mayor Irons and Council. I'm Colby Krotzer, Morro Bay. My heart went out to you, Council Member Johnson, when you were mentioning the fact that the staff lost a recommendation for a presentation on the sanctuary issue. It's familiar to me. I was on the council, sitting where you're sitting, for 8 years, and during that time, the council had supported, and I assume still does support, a lobbyist in Washington, D.C. And the lobbyist's positions and the meetings were never made available to me. I asked repeatedly of Mayor Yates, Mayor Novak, Mayor Anderson, and I was always, as a council member, kept in the dark about what exactly was the agenda of that lobbyist. And we know that these decisions about placement on a list for NOAA and the subsequent selection is a matter of our Congress, but it's heavily influenced by lobby influence. My suspicion was that lobbying influence was specifically working at the behest of a special interest group here in Morro Bay. That Morro Bay is known nationally, not up and down the coast, and I don't want to be run over by a truck, and I don't care how many bells ring on board. It's really a matter of nationally we are known. The city of Morro Bay is known for actions such as trying to unlist this NOI plover from an endangered species list. It's known more than that as the one impediment to consideration of a marine sanctuary to protect the Central Coast, to protect the fishing industry. I love fish. I want them to be successful, but I do want children and grandchildren to be plying the seas and supplying me and other consumers with fish. It's a healthy food source that may, in fact, sustain our threatened population on Earth as things change. I myself am Native American. My brothers are on the Rosebud Reservation facing frontline skirmishes with Exxon, the Keystone Pipeline. This is about protecting the water there. This is about protecting the water here. There really is common cause. In Lakota, we say mitak kuye oyasin, that all things are related. And this council is the one out of 20 years that probably is intellectually capable of seeing that this hoop of life is essential for all of our sustenance. Thank you.
Thanks, Colby.
Good evening. I'm Debbie Highfill from Morro Bay. Why do we need a sanctuary? We need permanent protection from oil drilling. That's the issue. Everyone suffers. When we have oil, we have spills. That's the way it goes. It's not permanent. We need permanent. I lived in Santa Barbara in 69 and was an eyewitness to that spill. That's number one. Please keep that in mind. Thank you.
Thanks, Debbie.
Hatu, Micha Kalesi, Wami Tana Tilhini, Mishju Tichu, Yak Tilhini, Wa Thisamu, Wasapatsu. Hello, my name is Kelsey, and I am a resident here at Morro Bay. I'm also here as a representative of a Northern Chumash tribe not affiliated with Fred Collins or the Northern Chumash Tribal Council. We are here locally, have always been here for over 10,000 years, and our place here in this area has been documented through our grandmother, who was the last speaker of the Northern Chumash language called Obispeño Chumash. So just to make that clear, we were not involved in the planning process or in the proposal that was put together by Fred Collins and his group. So I just want to make that clear as well. Just like the gentleman before me stated that the Santa Ynez tribe was not included and nor were they approving their census in this matter. However, on the other hand, we do support the idea of a marine sanctuary here. For many of the reasons stated, there's pros and cons to this situation. We understand that no matter what situation that we're going to have to protect our marine life and to protect our maritime activities here, there's always going to be pros and cons. The matter is, how are we going to balance that, and how are we going to find resolutions to take on those issues? Coming here tonight, while my tribe and myself were in support of the sanctuary, brings up a lot of concerns about answers that are not provided to you who are here to vote tonight. There's a lot of information out there. You've heard a lot of stuff tonight, so I would just recommend that this should be up for consideration. However, I feel that it needs to have due diligence, and you guys want to be comfortable with the decision that you're making. So I just encourage that, and thank you for your time. Oh, wow.
Thank you.
Emily Miggins, Los Osos. You stole my fire.
You guys have to
wrap this up. I'm an executive committee member of the local Sierra Club. I've served also on the national level with the Sierra Club. I also just graduated from Corporate America, and I've discussed this with your colleagues in the next communities right below here, south of here, regarding this marine sanctuary. There's one big factor that I think isn't reflected in a lot of these discussions, which is one, due diligence. And you really don't sound prepared at all, nor does staff, frankly, to answer those at this time. So I think I would find it very hard that you would make a decision without the appropriate research and information being vetted. Secondly, there is this big thing called corporate America. And to be honest with you, there's a whole discussion going on with sustainability metrics and reporting standards within the sourcing of seafood products. And that those decisions within corporate America, and I can rattle off the names of a few, such as Whole Foods, such as Safeway, Albertsons, those who are grocers here in our local communities, they involve a lot of science that we have depended on from NOAA, from Monterey Bay Aquarium, and then organizations like World Wildlife Fund and the Marine Stewardship Council, Earth Island, and many others. And the fishing community doesn't always like it. Some fishermen do. I've been involved sourcing millions upon millions, tons of tuna fish from the coasts of California for commercial production. And we always look at sustainability factors. So just wanted to relay that to you because I think it's really important in the decision that you make tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Council. My name's Bill Ward. I don't recognize any of you. You don't recognize me. I'm from Arroyo Grande. Well, I'll take that back. I recognize Eric. He lends legitimacy to you. Okay. I've been a full-time commercial fisherman here since 1968. I was appointed or elected to the Central Coast Joint Liaison Committee, Fisheries Cable Liaison Committee, in about 2003. And this is a outfit that's pumped a lot of money into the local infrastructure, both in Port San Luis and in Morro Bay. You can look around and see it. A lot of scholarships, a lot of things like that. I got a little story for you. The cable thing came along in 2000, about 2003, an outfit by the name of Global Photon started putting in a cable. It was going to be a festoon from San Diego all the way to San Francisco. It started San Diego, went to Orange County, ended up in Goleta, and landed up here at the old Standard Oil terminal there. Next stop was Moss Landing. Couldn't get a permit. Sanctuary wouldn't let them land their cable there. You got a dead cable out here that's a lot of money. Deutsche Bank is on the hook for about $8 billion for this thing. So as we know, Moss Landing has lots and lots and lots of research projects. In the summertime, you can't hardly fish there because of stuff they've got on the bottom and their research boats and whatnot. And I'm fuzzy on my facts, but I'm positive on my story here. Either Moss Landing Marine Labs or the research arm of the aquarium, about probably 2008, 2009, decided that they needed a cable in for research, you know. So they got it all put together. They notified the fishermen. They put their fiber optic cable in on a plateau out on the edge of the canyon and landed it in Moss Landing. The Joint Cable Committee has a meeting every February. We disperse money. We do business like that. And we've had two of the guys, Bob Wargo from AT&T, has been on the thing forever. We know him very well. He said, "Hey, Bob, what happened there?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "They put it in." He said they used Global Photon's landing plan right there. Couldn't put it in for
I'm going to have to ask you to conclude.
Okay. That's our sanctuary.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. First of all, thank you for moving this item up. Clearly, there was a lot of public comment. It is unfortunate we had a number of people leave the audience tonight, and then there's a number that aren't going to speak. So just keep that in mind.
I thought a lot about what I was going to say, and I think I'm going to just stick with what I wrote. But basically, my name's Andrea Luker. I'm a resident of Los Osos, and I'm here this evening to strongly urge you to not support the Chumash National Marine Sanctuary suggested for our Central Coast waters. I left a letter with Dana, your city clerk, authored by our Protected Coast Coalition, which somebody, I think, related to Big Oil, which is not the case, just to say that our Protected Coast Coalition is a true grassroots organization recently formed by concerned citizens deciding to concentrate their efforts on opposing a sanctuary. I ask that the letter be included as a formal record, and it's addressed to John Armour, who is the acting director of NOAA in Maryland. There was one specific area that I wanted to touch base from that letter, and I'll just read it to you. And basically, it is the National Marine Sanctuary Act provides National Marine Sanctuary's Secretary of Commerce with the ability to overrule the Regional Fisheries Management Council. Overrule the Regional Fisheries Management Council. That is a very important point for you to understand this evening. Sanctuaries encourage and establish marine protected areas. A number of your speakers have talked about that tonight, which are no fishing zones. Our direct experience with California shows that sanctuary actions led to the removal of some of the most productive fish habitat from fishing, resulting in safety at sea implications, which you've already heard. I would urge you to stay with the history of Morro Bay, even with the comment about mental power and ineptness that we heard just a minute ago, which is unfortunate. But City of Morro Bay has opposed this in 2011, 2003, 2001, and 2000. I will remind you, and it hasn't come up yet this evening, but your Harbor Advisory Board recommended that you oppose a sanctuary. That vote was 7-0. 7-0 on your advisory board, a board that you've appointed. I think with that, I would just ask you to support our local and regional fishermen and oppose the sanctuary this evening. Thanks. Have a good rest of your meeting.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Janice Peters, resident of Morro Bay. A couple of things that have been said tonight, I just wanted to add another thought to. First of all, given what is happening on the national, federal level, and who may be in power next, oil drilling may become the most important thing to next administration, in which case, nothing's going to stop them. So there's that. Number two. Dredging. The problem with dredging is, as Jim said, the spoils. Where do you put the spoils? We get our dredging money out of the federal budget every year, and we pray that they will maintain it every year because we couldn't afford to do it. So if we cannot get the dredging spoils put someplace closer and it gets more expensive to get out of that federal budget, we're going to have a harder time getting those monies. The Advisory Council and their ability to approve whatever NOAA has said. They're appointed by NOAA. The Advisory Council is appointed. They're not elected. So, of course, they're going to kind of go with the people who appointed them. Morro Bay is known for a lot of things in Washington, mainly for working together, for working on our fishing industry, for supporting it. When this whole issue came up in the early 90s, we formed a group called the Marine Interest Group. It had, I believe, 12 members from environmental, science, fishing, elected officials, and we educated ourselves on marine issues for a period of 3 years before it disbanded. Never once did we come to agreement on the safety of a sanctuary because of lack of local control. Once you give that to NOAA, and I went back to Washington lots of times, and a lot of the people, I won't say a lot, some of the people at NOAA have never been to California. They have no idea what our coastline is like, what our needs are, what our fishing industry is. It's a little scary to have decisions that are going to affect us, a small city. We don't have a lot of economic clout or voting clout in Washington. And to have those decisions made by some people who've never even been to California. A sanctuary is a wonderful idea, but if you don't have local control that means something, it can be devastating to our community.
Thanks, Janice. Anybody else for public comment?
Fred Collins, Tribal Administrator, Northern Chumash Tribal Council.
Mayor Irons, council members, staff, thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I come from my council and the council of the elders with caring in my heart, compassion, and as a human being. Human beings need to take care of each other. Human beings need to respect each other. This is something that is lacking today in this world. Several years ago, there was a process where large corporation PG&E wanted to do some offshore seismic testing along our coast. We were the last people to find out about this. And when we did, we were able to collaborate with the local community in a way that allowed us to meet down at the Coastal Commission in Santa Monica. And this was a last-ditch effort. All of the other agencies had approved the seismic testing. And we were able to collaborate with a broad community of grassroots folks and have a strong feeling and a strong caring for our ocean. I admit, I'm here as a preserver of all the things that are connected to make this reality that we call life. I stand as a preserver for my culture, my heritage. I stand to preserve these things in a way that works for everybody. When we were able to come together as a community and stop this dangerous, absolutely horrible seismic testing, it was a great feeling to be a part of this community in the way that we all came together. And again, we're at a situation where it's a community-wide opportunity. Just because one group or one agency has a permit to take a resource from something that belongs to all of us does not make them the rulers of that resource. It is the people of this community. It is the people of my community, the indigenous community, who have been here and been caretakers for this great ocean for over 10,000 years. And we say to you, we bring this opportunity to engage with NOAA, to engage with an agency that can stop offshore oil drilling immediately, can stop seismic testing, can protect our ancient sites which are buried underneath the water. And we ask you, Fred, to be open to this process and move forward in a way,
please conclude,
that
Fred,
we can all work together. Thank you, Jamie.
Thank you, Council Member. Appreciate it.
Good evening. Debbie Wood from Morro Bay Landing. I've heard a lot of things said here tonight. One thing that I heard was this was referred to as Mr. Collins' sanctuary. Let's be very clear, it is not Mr. Collins' sanctuary. It will be the federal government's sanctuary, and they will do whatever they darn well please, whether we like it or not. It's been said that it will stop oil drilling. And it will until the federal government decides they need the oil, and then it will start up again. It's been said that it's the only way to keep the ocean healthy. Well, we have a clean, healthy ocean and ecosystem here right now. There are 17 governing bodies to make sure that that happens. I don't believe we need another one. It says once this starts, and starts to move forward, as was pointed out by an earlier speaker, we can go to the meetings and we can give our opinions, but we will not have anything to say about the final outcome or the final rules that will govern this sanctuary. That will come from Washington, D.C. In speaking to a member of the advisory council in for the Channel Islands, every member of the committee down there, NOAA's people, with a rank above secretary or janitor, now live in and around Santa Barbara, Ventura area, but none of them came from there. Every one of them came from east of the Mississippi. I believe it to be entirely possible for you to be blindsided by the rules and regulations of this sanctuary about many things. It would not include the bay or the harbor, but believe me, it would have a lasting effect on the bay and the harbor and your ability to do business. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, City Council, my name is Wayne Moody. I've been a commercial fisherman for over 40 years. I was on the board of the Pacific Coast Federation's Fishermen's Association back when the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary was in its initial stages. And commercial fishermen did get behind that because of the oil and gas exploration issue. All of a sudden, if that's why the fishermen got behind it, how come the fishermen have totally turned around and are totally against sanctuaries? It's because we were given a promise in that sanctuary that they wouldn't regulate fishing. And basically they don't. But just like it was mentioned earlier, they go and back door and they get in their regulations through talking to other agencies, other governmental agencies. So we can't trust them. Mr. Bill Duras was the superintendent back. He's now back in Washington, D.C. He's got a higher-paying job now, but he was the superintendent in Monterey Bay. And I'm not exactly sure how many years it is, but they have a designation document. I think Eric alluded to that. It's kind of the bylaws that they go with. And they review those documents. They can change those after they've actually come out. So you can get one thing, and a few years down the road, it's totally different. I think there was an issue asked or a question asked by the council about did the sanctuary in Monterey Bay protect from oil and gas exploration up there? Well, there's no oil and gas exploration up there, but there's no oil and gas exploration. We don't see any north of Point Sal down here. We don't have a marine sanctuary out here right now, so there's no oil and gas exploration. And I want to point out, it was mentioned earlier, there's still issues with the sanctuary process by the different harbors, the fishermen and the cities that have these sanctuaries. So those items hadn't been fixed yet. How long are we going to have to wait? Thank you, and I hope that you still support being, you're the really enlightened city council, so much smarter than all these other ones. I hope you still support those resolutions. Thank you.
Thank you, Wayne.
Mr. Mayor, Morro Bay City Council, my name is Trudy O'Brien. I'm a resident of Morro Bay since 1976 and a former commercial fisherman. I'm here tonight to just ask that you support the Harbor Advisory Board's recommendation with a vote of 7-0 to oppose the Chumash National Marine Sanctuary. I think the main thing I've been hearing throughout the public speaking tonight is the lack of local support. I would just hope that you support our Harbor Advisory Board. I was there the other night last week, and I was very, very proud of them. I think we have them in place for a reason, and I would hope you listen to them. And thank you very much. I wish Jeremiah was here to speak to you on this, besides missing him. He would also tell you much more than this. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Trudy. Anybody else for public comment? Seeing none, I'll close public comment. And I'm going to ask for a short break if the rest of council is up to it. I think we need a little bit of a break, and we'll be right back. Thank you.